Tonight's Freedom Bowl between the Iowa Hawkeyes and the Texas Longhorns is being brought to you in part by your local Amana heating and cooling contractor, by RJ Building Products, your kitchen and bath outlet for Eastern Iowa, and by Old Milwaukee and Old Milwaukee Light.
The Iowa Hawkeyes had hoped to be in Southern California this time of year, and while it's not Pasadena, it's the next best thing. Led by junior quarterback Chuck Long, Iowa was in the Rose Bowl hunt until shocking back-to-back losses to Michigan State and Minnesota. Their one consensus All-American, linebacker Larry Station, had 47 more tackles than anyone else on the team, and he's an academic All-American. The Texas Longhorns have two consensus All-Americans, and one is described by an opposing head coach as the most dominating defensive back he's ever seen, senior Jerry Gray. And while Gray chases footballs, Tony DeGray chases quarterbacks, a team-high 13 sacks for the winner of the Lombardi Trophy. It's Texas and Iowa in the first-ever Freedom Bowl from Anaheim, California. Stay with us. Metro Sports presents the first annual Freedom Bowl. It's the Iowa Hawkeyes of the Big Ten meeting the Texas Longhorns of the Southwest Conference. Darkness has fallen over the Big A in Anaheim, California, and with it, some rain. Yes, we have rain in Southern California for the first ever Freedom Bowl matchup between the Texas Longhorns and the Iowa Hawkeyes. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Freedom Bowl. I'm Sam Nover. Delighted to have you with us and delighted that TCS Metro Sports could be part of the inaugural Freedom Bowl here in Anaheim, California. We had hoped for better weather. We haven't gotten it. We hope for a great football game. We expect to get it. Working with me today, former Notre Dame All-American and former Los Angeles Rams star Jack Snow. And Jack, we know that the coaches feel this game is important to them. They want to go into the 85 season on a plus note. How about Texas and Freddie Akers?
Well, you know, they had a good year. They only finished a game out of the conference championship. They've got some excellent ball players. The injuries have hurt them a lot this year. There's no question that. You know, we're going to see two fine All-American kids on Texas. We'll talk about them later. Good ball game. Texas wants to continue winning in 84 and start off 85 in a positive manner, and they need to win this ball game today to do that.
Texas's defense has really been the essence of their entire establishment, I guess you could say. They have gone as far as the defense has taken them, and in Jerry Gray and Tony DeGray, they have outstanding players, but they did give up 61 points in their last two losses.
They did. They lost a little bit of consistency, and that may be because of some injuries to key people and the fact that different teams thought, well, we've got to keep the ball. We don't want to give it up, and let's just put the ball in the air and do a job, and they did.
Hayden Fry was in the thick of the Rose Bowl hunt with the Iowa Hawkeyes, and then something bad happened to him on the way to the Rose Bowl. They lost a couple of football games, and he's got to be distressed about that.
He is. There's no question. Hayden is a true competitor out there. There's no doubt he wants to win this ball game today. His team is really banged up, so it's going to be interesting to see how well they can do.
And in Iowa, you'll see one of the best quarterbacks in all of the land, Chuck Long, and they also have an outstanding running back in Owen Gill. We'll be back to preview the players in this game and more of our pregame report, the first-ever Freedom Bowl from Anaheim, and we'll continue after this. Welcome back to the Big A in Anaheim, California, the first ever Freedom Bowl, the Texas Longhorns and the Iowa Hawkeyes. And it's apparent that both teams have gotten here because of their outstanding individual talents. You know about Jerry Gray. You know about Tony DeGray. Some of the people who will play key roles in this football game today that you may not have heard a great deal about, we would like to show you and talk a little bit more about them today. And we might very well start with the quarterback of the Texas Longhorns. It's been an up-and-down season for Todd Dodge. When he's good, he's very, very good. And when he's bad, he's almost naughty, Jack.
1,600 yards of passing. He's completed 100 passes of 210 attempts. Not too bad statistics, just a little under 50%. Injuries have plagued him. Also, he's thrown for 11 touchdowns, but he's had 19 interceptions, and that hurts an offense.
And one of the reasons that Texas has thrown the ball so much this year is that the running game has not been what Texas running games have been in the past. But when they call in a key man, it's usually number 37, Terry Orr.
Terry Orr, a big back, 6'3", 230 pounds. He's a big, strong guy. He hits the middle very good. He's got excellent speed, averaging 4.6 yards a carry, and has scored 7 touchdowns for the Longhorns.
And might we add that fullback Jerome Johnson is back in the lineup. He should not only help the running, but the blocking for Terry Orr. Defensively, June James helps to complement and augment that great defensive to Graydon Gray.
June James will be playing right outside linebacker for the Longhorns. He'll be wearing number 62, 6'2", 221 pounds, senior. 120 tackles, 8 sacks, and 8 tackles behind the line of scrimmage. Outstanding statistics for the linebacker.
I think when people hear about Iowa, Jack, they talk a lot about the offense. Chucky Long has had just an outstanding season, the number one passer in the country. But this is a team that also plays some pretty good defense, and we'll talk about them. But let's get to Long, and let's get to this passing game. Who does he deliver the football to most frequently? His tight end, Jonathan Hayes, to start with, the young man who had 39 catches this year.
Number 34 in your program, number one in your heart, 6'5", 245-pound junior, the leading receiver for Iowa, 39 receptions, 4 touchdowns. Excellent, excellent, big target, and he can run with the ball after he makes a catch.
And if there's one player that you have to have the utmost respect for, it'd be running back Owen Gill. He's been asked to do a lot of things. When Ronnie Harmon went out, Owen Gill had to go back to tailback. He had played some fullback. He's done everything they've asked of him, and he's a career rushing leader at Iowa.
As you can see, 2,500 yards total. This year alone, he's 859 yards. He's averaging 4.7 yards per crack. He scored 4 touchdowns, and he's a do-it-all. The question is, how long can he play, Sam?
And there's also another big question, and that's whether or not Devon Mitchell will play in this game. He is the best player in their secondary, the free safety, and we learned just before game time he is hurt and may not play, or if so, he'll play sparingly, Jack.
There's going to be a question mark on Devon, naturally, but he'll come up, he'll force the run, as you watch it right here, number 2, or 21. He'll bang, he'll hit you real good. He's a leading interceptor for the Hawkeyes with 5 in the secondary. He may be the second best defensive player for Iowa.
And we're not only blessed with 2 great football teams, we are blessed with 2 of the most notable coaches in the entire land. Fred Akers of Texas, Hayden Fry of Iowa will come back and meet our head coaches right after this commercial break. Welcome again to the Big A in Anaheim, California, the first ever Freedom Bowl, Texas and Iowa, the participants today. It's for sure that Texas belongs to be here, and so too their head coach, Fred Akers. He is in his 8th year at Texas, and every year Texas has gone to a bowl game. And also in terms of percentage of victories, he is 10th among the active coaches in all of college football. Before today's game, I asked Coach Akers whether the injuries to his team will affect the quality of their play.
Well, we're no different than anyone else. Our starters are better than our second teamers, and our second teamers are better than our third teamers. But, you know, I'm still proud of all our players, and I hope that whoever we put out there is going to do the best job he can. But, yes, I mean, no team can be as good without their first teamers.
Todd Dodge has had, as you well know better than anybody else, an up-and-down season. I guess he's like the little girl with a curl in the middle of her forehead, huh? When he's good, he's very, very good, and when he's bad, he's naughty.
Yes, he's had an up-and-down season this year. The games we've been able to win have been in a big part due to his play. And when he wasn't able to come with the big plays, we didn't have the chance to win that he provides us when he's on.
Tony DeGrate and Jerry Gray have provided defensive leadership. You expect that to carry, obviously, through this football game. Has the rest of your defensive unit matured as the season went along?
I think that our whole football team has had a chance to mature. We were very, very young when we started on both sides of the ball. We had to replace a lot of good football players from a year ago. But we're a much more mature football team right now.
Well, in terms of maturity, you might also think that Fred Akers is mature, Jack. I think he probably has. Over the years, he's had to throw the ball more this year than at any time in Texas memory.
No question. He's been averaging about 20 to 25 passes per game. I think he's being a little bit sly, though, Sam. I think 2 things today. Number one, I think he realizes his defense maybe can control Iowa, but I think he realizes offensively they've got to keep the ball away from Iowa, and if Dodge doesn't have a good day, they're going to be in real trouble.
And you talk about charismatic coaches. Hayden Fry would fit the example. He's a classic example. He took this team to the Rose Bowl in 1981, lost to Washington, hoped to be in the Rose Bowl next week, in fact, but he's happy with the Freedom Bowl, and he's particularly happy about his quarterback, Chuck Long.
Well, of course, Chuck Long is just a super quarterback. Chuck is uncanny in regards to his accuracy. He's not a pitcher book passer, but he always puts the ball on target. Texas plays great man-for-man defense, have tremendous speed in the secondary. The field's a little wet today, and I'm not for sure about our footing, how good we can cut. If we can cut precisely, then we should have a pretty good day throwing the ball. Of course, the big problem is to give Chuck the protection he needs. But Owen Gill is hurt. He's got 2 bad ankles. He's got a bad neck. He's had a bruised kidney. We're going to play Owen as long as he can play. play and then bring in a little walk-on guy by the name of Rick Bayless, who was really the star of the Hawaii victory, and go from there. So if Gil can play, wonderful. If he can't, we'll probably have to rely more on Chuck Long's passing.
You almost feel that Hayden Fry wants you to bring out the violins and play a chorus of blues or something for him, but I have a feeling he'll get his team ready.
They're going to be ready. One big problem he has had, though, they've only been outside 3 days since the Hawaii game, and that could take its toll through the course of this ball game. You know, you can work inside for so much, but I'll tell you what, though, you got to have that outside practice for your timing.
Iowa's a great football team. Texas, for 2 weeks this year, was ranked number one in the country. We've got the makings of an excellent football game. It's the Freedom Bowl, and more of our pregame activities comes right after this. Brought to you by Daily's Juice Products, who remind you there's a daily treat for everyone. By Sony, the one and only. By Timex Quartz, from the most elegant to the most athletic. Open your eyes to the genius of Timex. And by American Oil. Expect more from Amoco. We go that extra mile. Hello again, everyone. Sam Dover and Jack Snow, and we're at the Freedom Bowl in Anaheim, California, with the pregame activities now taking place on the field. And as we come back to you live, so does our skydiver, who comes right into the stadium and at the 50-yard, well, a sliding delivery at the 42-yard line.
Beautiful block, Sam.
A rather inauspicious arrival, but he arrived safely. An 85-foot flag is being unfurled here. It is the largest flag ever made by a Mr. Ski Dembski of Southern California. And that is our cue for the national anthem.
By a World War II POW, Joe Verdugo.
Beautiful sight. The balloons now being unleashed from behind one of the benches, the unfurling of this American flag, and a shot from the Goodyear blimp high above the Big A here in Anaheim. And with the plane and singing of our national anthem, we are just a moment or so away from the start of today's football game, or tonight if you're viewing in the east. What a beautiful sight, Jack. The red, white, and blue balloons have now been released from the boxes behind the bench on the far side, with a red, white, and blue flag on the near side. And the only thing I guess we're missing is the capacity crowd that we had hoped for, but the weather certainly has been a deterrent. It began raining about 2 o'clock this afternoon out here in Anaheim, and has let up considerably. And while the field will be wet, I would hope that if we don't get any further rain, it won't appreciably interfere with the quality of play in this game.
Sam, I think the thing that you might interest the viewers is probably the wettest portion of the field is going to be in the end zone. The rest of the field was kept pretty much dry the entire last couple of days, I should say. You know, the tarp was on, and it was on until the very last minute, till about, 3:45, 4 o'clock this afternoon. So the field should be in pretty good shape.
This is the same field, of course, used as the home field by the Los Angeles Rams in their playoff loss the other day to the New York Giants. And the field has been made over somewhat, but not as completely as perhaps the Freedom Bowl people had hoped. You see the weather conditions at game time. It's 55 degrees, and the skies, obviously, the rain intermittent, and it's down to just a very slight drizzle at the moment. And the wind's variable. They should not be a factor if the conditions hold up for the next 3 hours or so. And it's really a darn shame because it's been a positively magnificent week here in Southern California. The last 3 days, the temperature has reached the low 70s during the afternoons. As you see our camera in the Iowa locker room now as the players start to move out and head for the playing field for the player introductions and the coin toss, which will come at the 50-yard line just momentarily. But it has been delightful weather. And wouldn't you know it, that on the inaugural of the Freedom Bowl, that the rains would fall early in the afternoon, and it's been cloudy and certainly would keep this crowd down. They had sold in the neighborhood of 30,000 tickets for this football game prior to today, and they had hoped to have a sizable gate sale with some very good publicity in recent days by the local television stations and the papers. But I would think that probably the weather has been a deterrent, as I suggested, Jack.
California's a very spoiled people, Sam. You know, we're used to having that sun about 360 days of the year, and we're also used to having temperatures at the low end of 65 and the high end of about 100. And normally in December for us, we're in the low to mid to high 70s at different times of the year in our winter months. So the day is very, very unexpected.
So Hayden Fry has brought his Iowa team all the way out here to Anaheim with the hopes of winning a bowl game and erasing the drudgery of a couple of losses to Michigan State particularly, and then won the following week to Minnesota that cost him any hopes at all, as you see Hayden Fry and the Iowa Hawkeyes. Any chances at all of going to the Rose Bowl, and they were very much in the hunt until they had lost that Michigan State game. They are lined up now, coming out at the right side of the field. Hayden Fry, having coached previously at West Texas State and SMU, happy as can be at Iowa. And might we also suggest to you that this will be a partisan Iowa crowd. Texas brought just a couple of hundred people along, claiming that this coming the day after Christmas certainly inhibited the number of people who might want to come. And now the Longhorns coming out of the dugout on the other side of the field and passing through their cheerleaders to a rather mixed reception here from, as I indicated, partisan Iowa crowd.
I think those white jerseys that the Longhorns are wearing are going to be mighty dirty before the night's over with.
It won't take very long at all. This is a team that has been led by two outstanding consensus All-Americans, Jerry Gray, the safety, Tony DeGrate, the defensive tackle, who went on to win the Lombardi Award. And they have been surrounded with a rather suspect defense and inexperienced defense to start the year, yet they played brilliantly, going 6-0-1 over the first seven games until they ran into a buzzsaw in Houston, then lost to Baylor, then lost to Texas A&M, and finished on a rather sour note, certainly for Texas teams at 7-3-1. But the defense did mature, as you heard Fred Aker say during our pregame show. They developed rather rapidly, and they've come along, and they've been rather supportive of Tony DeGrate and Jerry Gray, and would obviously bode very well for the future of Texas defense. See if we can't pick up the coin flip here. Well, apparently we're having some technical difficulties with our microphone on the officials, and we'll just have to wait for the designation as to which team won the coin flip and who will receive and who will kick off to start the football game. They are deploying now, and Texas will be to our left. And as our referee indicates, go ahead and indicate, referee. Iowa receives, and Texas will kick off to start the inaugural Freedom Bowl from the Big A in Anaheim, California. And we'll be back with the opening kickoff in just a moment. So Jeff Ward now about to put the ball on the kicking tee at the 40-yard line to start this football game. An excellent kicker is Jeff Ward. And Iowa deploying now to receive the kick in the deep receiving spots. Number 2, Robert Smith, and number 6, Kerry Bird. As you look at the officials' crew for this Freedom Bowl, Jack Gato is the referee. Crittenden, Athen, Pereira, Rice, Jury, and Jordan, the rest of the officiating crew. Iowa's 3-2 in bowl games, and Hayden Fry has an overall record of 2-4. And for Texas, this is their 31st bowl game. They are second only to Alabama in the number of bowl games they participated in, the Crimson Tide having appeared in 35 of them. And Ward is about set to go, and so are we. Welcome aboard. From Anaheim, California, it's a short kick, and Kerry Bird at his 15 to the 20, and he rolls to about the 25-yard line before he is stopped. Man making the tackle is John Hagee, number 17, to get it started. And so the Hawkeyes will begin just shy of their own 25-yard line, and they will begin with Chucky Long at quarterback. And you see the Hawkeyes offense, which has been very productive, averaging 25 points a game and 383 net yards. So they come out of it now with the ball spotted right at their own 24-yard line. In the pro set backfield, Fred Bush, number 35, and Owen Gill. And Gill gets the ball and loses a yard. Owen Gill, the ball carrier, stopped at the 23-yard line as Stephen Braggs, a strong safety, number 6, is a man who made the stop. There's your backfield. Long, Gill, and Bush. And Fred Bush will use primarily as a blocking back. Jonathan Hayes, the outstanding tight end, with Happel and Helverson, the wideouts. And the offensive line, they begin Wester, Glass, Sindlinger, O'Brien, and Haight. But they are a beaten-up offensive line physically. And we may see some other people during the course of the day. It is second down, 11 for the Hawkeyes. Long play-action pass. The rush is on. He's chased all the way back to the 5-yard line and throws it away. Pass was intended for Mike Flagg, the tight end. Tony DeGrate had the pressure, and he chased Long all the way back to the 5-yard line. So it'll be third down for Iowa as you look at the defensive unit of Texas. McKinney, the great DeGrate. Hethcock and Brawner up front, the linebacking crew. Ty Allard, Edwards, and June James, who we previewed in our pregame show, with Lott, who is picked on frequently in this group. Tillman and Braggs and the All-American Jerry Gray. Here we go now, third down, 11 for Iowa. First offensive series of the game. They have the ball at their own 23-yard line. And Long again back to pass. Flares it out to Robert Smith, and he's dropped for a loss all the way back to the 17-yard line. They call it an incompleted pass to a rather inauspicious beginning for the Hawkeyes, Jack.
Not real good. They want to get off to a better start than that. The first series of the ball game, they've got to get a little confidence going. They want to have at least maybe a 2 or 3 series type drive to get them some confidence offensively. But unfortunately, the good defense that Texas has prohibited that.
And Rob Morshall now back in the single safety at his own 47-yard line. As the Iowa Hawkeyes are set to punt the ball away, Gary Coscarballa, and he has a punt that goes off the side of his foot and out of bounds. Not bad. He didn't totally shank the ball. You see where they spot it. They walk it back into Iowa territory, and they will spot the ball in the neighborhood of the Iowa 45-yard line. So it wasn't all that good at all, and gives the Texas Longhorns superb field position to start this game. A punt of only 22 yards and nothing on the return. So when we come back, the Texas Longhorns and Todd Dodge and company go to work their first possession of the day. Scoreless, just underway here from the Big A in Anaheim, California, the Freedom Bowl. And there you see Texas on the season averaging 321 yards of total offense per game at 22 points. But in their last 6 games, they have scored over 15 but once. And they begin with Rob Morshall at the tailback. And Todd Dodge is sprint out pass completed on the far side of the field. The ball is fumbled, and the scramble is on. And let's see who's got it. Iowa's got the ball. They completed their first offensive play to tight end William Harris. And he fumbled the ball in the neighborhood of the 35-yard line, and Iowa has recovered. So the Hawkeyes come with a big break here, Jack.
Coming right out of the chute. Watch him right here. Dodge going back. He's going to his big play guy, William Harris, 34 catches. He makes the catch nice. He tucks the ball away, but he really gets popped pretty good. He gets hit very, very hard in there. Let's see. Look at it again now here from ground level. You see him short rollout. That's to avoid the rush. Lay the ball in the flat. Harris makes a nice catch. Boy, he gets smacked right there pretty good by number 41, Mike Stoops, a strong safety who has had a great year.
And George Davis in, and they knock that ball free, and so Iowa gets the ball back in better field position than they began this game. They are now at their own 37-yard line, and the give is to the running back, Owen Gill, for a couple of yards out over the 40 before he's stopped by strong safety Stephen Braggs. Let's give him a gain of about 3 on the carry. It'll be second down and 7. Iowa now running the ball from just across their own 40-yard line following the fumble. Texas, an outstanding defense. Less than 300 yards per game have they given up. But not a Texas defense that certainly has distinguished itself, certainly in terms of tradition. Their teams of the past have been much better. However, 22 of their players graduated last year, went on to sign pro contracts. Here's the pitch to the near side, and Owen Gill has nothing there as he reaches the 40-yard line, may have lost a yard. In the grasp of defensive end Blake Brawner, number 85, a junior out of Richardson, Texas. So it'll be third down and long for Iowa, and they've yet to move the ball now in five plays from scrimmage.
Little quick toss here to Gill. He's trying to get outside, but Brawner, 85, who's had an excellent year for the Longhorns, comes in, avoids the blocker, makes a tackle for another loss. It's nine tackles behind the line of scrimmage for number 85, Blake Brawner, this year.
This game has really switched depending on the feeling of the country. Iowa at one point was a one-point favorite. Texas then became a one-point favorite. Then Iowa, long on third and eight, rolling out to his right, has time this time. Now the pressure in his face, and he delivers the ball incomplete, and nobody was open. Credit Texas's defense with having really defended the pass very well, and James McKinney finally forced Long to throw the ball, and it's fourth down now, and the Hawkeyes will have to kick it away again.
Interesting concept on that one, Sam. He came out with only one receiver in mind, tried to go to Scott Helverson, but he could not do it. You've got to get a second man into that secondary as a backup receiver.
Here's Gary Castrovalla, and he really booms this one to Rob Morshiel. Lets it go over his head. Takes an Iowa bounce and will be killed inside the two-yard line. So Castrovalla really redeemed himself for his first kick and puts this one dead right on the two-yard line. A punt of 58 yards by the Iowa punter. And Texas begins with their back to the end zone. They'll have to huddle in the end zone, in fact, in a scoreless football game.
Great kick coverage right there. You need two things in a game, in a play like that. You need a good high kick, allow that punt coverage to get down, set up, and you need good coverage by the punting team, and they got both of that.
Here you go, the Texas offense, and they didn't have the ball long enough last time for us to show you, but Todd Dodge will start at quarterback as usual. They will start Rob Morshiel at the tailback, along with the Jerome Johnson. Your receivers are Harris, the tight end who fumbled, Duhon and Bill Boy Bryant, and the offensive line. Billy Ray Todd is a replacement for Blackmer, who was injured, and they really have trouble in that particular position. He is a 13 guard, and the give on first down, there's nothing there. As Iowa stacks it up, but there's a flag down. So it'll be, let's see what this call is all about.
Freddie Ickers is a little bit upset right now. He wants that offense to get going. Let's get something going, guys. Let's get out of this area. Let's move the ball downfield a little bit. Listen to the call here.
Offside. So the offside against Iowa, they walk off the five, and that Hayden Fry's got to be steaming about that. You stop him on first down at the two-yard line, give him 5 yards, and for all intents and purposes, get him out of trouble. So Texas now with a first down and five from their own seven-yard line, and they've got the pro set backfield with Johnson and Morshiel. And Johnson fumbles the ball, and it's laying there at the 12-yard line, and Iowa's got it. Mike Stoops fell on the ball, and so for the second time, Texas has fumbled the ball. Are they going to allow this or not? I don't see anybody. I don't see Texas coming off the field. I don't believe they're going to allow it, Jack.
I don't know. It looked like it was a fumble to me. I don't quite understand that call.
So apparently the fumble will not be allowed, and that was an interesting call. As a ball laid there for an eternity, and finally Stoops realized it was a free ball and fell on it, but it's to no avail as Texas retains it. There's your defensive unit for Iowa, the Hooks, Hufford, Drost, Little, and Gear, two outstanding linebackers, in particular Larry Station. Here we go on second down. And the pitch is to Rob Morshiel, a converted quarterback trying to get outside. He's brought down as he reaches the 11-yard line. He's stopped there by Jeff Drost, number 76, the nose guard. A 6'4", 286-pound sophomore from Indianola, Iowa. And it'll be third down now for the Texas Longhorns, and I believe they're shy of the first down. Coming off the field and somewhat hobbled there is number 64, Paul Hufford, who's an outstanding defensive tackle.
Let's take a look now and see. If his forward momentum is stopped or that knee hits the ground after he's hit, then it's a dead ball. They call it a dead ball right there, but it looks to me like that ball's coming out of his hands as he's getting stuck. Good play by Iowa. Unfortunately, get robbed of the call, Sam.
So it's third down. No, they gave him a first down on the play, so he did reach the first down. And here the run to the far sideline, and out of bounds is Todd Dodge on a keeper. They got the first down, I beg your pardon, and they have moved the stick, so Texas retains possession of the ball. And Dodge running for some yardage now out over the 15-yard line. It stepped out of bounds, stopping the clock.
He's going to fake in here to Marshall just to hold the linebackers, put the ball away, and head outside. He gets good blocking. The Iowa defense on the right side closes down to respect that fullback dive, and here goes Dodge. Smart quarterback. Get what you can and get out of bounds.
Actually gets across the 20-yard line, and they'll spot it very close to another Texas first down. So Iowa, having given them an opportunity here to get out of trouble, and Texas taking advantage of it as they have now a second down and one just shy of the 23-yard line. And the give is to Morshell, a first down and much more over the 25. And he is driven back as he reaches the 28-yard line, stopped by Kevin Spitzig, who's in at the inside linebacking spot along with Larry Station. But that will be another Longhorns first down as Texas has the ball now just shy of their own 30-yard line. And that is their second first down in this drive.
What's happening so far is that Iowa's going to be playing what we call a 34 defense. That's three down linemen and four linebackers. The secret to that defense is to keep the offensive linemen off your linebackers, let your linebackers make the tackle. So far in this drive that started at the two-yard line, that's exactly what Texas is doing. Those linemen are getting into Davis and Spitzig and stationing the linebackers and giving those backs some room to run.
And the rain continues to fall ever so lightly here in Anaheim as they send a man in motion to the near side. And here's Todd Dodge looking downfield, delivers a pass. It's intercepted. Stoops has it at the 35, working his way across field to the 25, to the 20, and inside the 20 to the 19. Number 41, Mike Stoops. So perhaps justice has been served here as one takeaway was not allowed, and they get it back again.
As we mentioned earlier in the show, Dodge will run the rollout. He does that to avoid the pressure, but on this play right here, he just throws the ball up for grabs. He's trying to get Peter Pope, the fullback. There's a great interception here by Stoops, who's been involved in all three key plays so far. Runs back downfield towards the goal line, picks his blockers up nicely, gets all he can.
That was only his second interception this year, but he had six last year and was an all Big Ten performer and tied for the Big Ten leadership in interception. So Stoops with a very big play. And look at Iowa now at the Texas 19-yard line. They've done nothing with their first two possessions. Here's Owen Gill at the 10. First down and goal at the 6.
Watch Owen here. It's nothing special. Just a straight drop back. You hand off on a little delayed draw type pattern. He gets out of the grasp of number 48, Ty Allard. Number 63 is in there trying to take a shot at him, but he skips by him and gets down about the 6-yard line, 7-yard line. Good running by Owen Gill.
June James and Jerry Gray with the saving tackles just outside the Texas 6. So here come the Hawkeyes now. They have been given two opportunities in this football game, this being the second, and let's see whether they can take advantage of it. Long play action pass. Looking in the end zone. Delivers a football, and it's incomplete. Intended for a diving Mike Flagg in the end zone. June James with the coverage, the linebacker. It is incomplete. It is second down and goal to go Iowa. And you might have noticed, Jack, some of this splashing water in the end zone as Flagg came running back. So there is some casual water sitting on this natural surface here in Anaheim, and you see some of the people crowded under their umbrellas.
Well, what you want to do as a receiver, if you can get a foot or a step on the defensive back, make him go one way, and then you come back the other, chances are he will fall down. But number 86, Mike Flagg, had good tight coverage. You couldn't put a real good move on that time on the Texas defensive back.
And the Longhorns send another defensive back into the lineup now. Number 17, John Hagee, on second down and 6 as Texas is looking for Chuck Long to throw the ball. Play action pass, he is rolling to his left. Throws it in the end zone, it's caught, touchdown Iowa! Number 34, Jonathan Hayes.
We're going to watch Hayes right here. Now he's number 34. He's going to delay a count or two, come out. You'll see him right there, right in the middle of your screen. Great shot. He's all alone right there. Goes up in the air to catch the ball, makes a catch, touchdown Iowa.
Just that easy. Tom Nickel will attempt the extra point.
There's a young man, 6'5" tall. What a great target he is to throw to.
So his 40th catch of the year is a touchdown, and Iowa draws first blood. Here's the placement, and the kick by Tom Nickel is up, and it is good. So having capitalized on the interception, the Iowa Hawkeyes have taken the lead in the first ever Freedom Bowl from Anaheim. It's 7-0 Iowa over Texas. We'll be back after this. A reminder that the broadcast rights to this game are granted by the Freedom Bowl Committee to TCS Metro Sports. Any rebroadcast or other use of this telecast without the express written consent is prohibited. The announcers on this telecast have been hired and paid for by TCS Metro Sports in consultation with the Freedom Bowl Committee.
Yeah.
So it's 7-0 Iowa following the touchdown pass by Chuck Long. And Tom Nichol will do the kicking to Kelvin Epps, number 40, and Kevin Nelson, number 32. There you see the time remaining. We haven't played much time here. We haven't have much elapsed time, but there's been considerable action. Texas has turned the ball over twice. In their first two possessions, Iowa was not able to do a thing, but in their third possession, they moved 19 yards with a touchdown pass to Jonathan Hayes. And here's a kick by Nichol. It is long and it is deep, 2 yards deep in the end zone. And here comes Nelson to the 15, to the 20, to the 25, and he's brought down to the 27-yard line. Number 99, Richard Pryor, is the man who made the stop, so Texas begins at its 27. Jack?
Watch long here. A little fake right here to the tailback. Holds the linebackers, and Hayes is going to sneak right in behind the linebackers. There he is right there, makes a good catch. Nice play, well-designed play, great execution.
Didn't take him long. 38 seconds and three plays, 7-0 Iowa. So here comes Texas. Let's see if they can get it back again. It's been a shaky beginning for this club. Harris fumbled on the very first play from scrimmage after catching a first down pass. And Todd Dodge has thrown an interception. And the give is to the upback, number 35, Jerome Johnson, for very short yardage. He is stopped by Larry Station, the consensus All-American, number 36. And Jack Hayden Fry just can't say enough about him.
He thinks Station is one of the greatest, not only ball players, but one of the greatest individuals he has ever had the pleasure of coaching. He's been an all-academic for a couple of years now. He's been an all-American academic. And he's just a great individual.
And he, more than anybody else, is responsive for whatever impressive stats they have defensively. Of course, it's obviously a team game, but Station is just such a perfectionist. When the offense is on the field, he's working on his technique. On the sideline, here's a give, and Johnson brought down at the 29-yard line. And yeah, you guessed it, it was number 36, Larry Station.
Look at that, 130 tackles this year. Now, those aren't all solos, but believe me, the majority of them are. Watch him here. A little misdirection. You fake the pitch to the tailback. You flip it to number 35, Jerome Johnson. Come back to the outside, and there's Station 36 sitting there waiting. Excellent job by Larry Station.
Third down and 7 for Todd Dodge, who, as we indicated during the pregame show, has had a most up-and-down season. He's done some things very well, and he's set a new interception record for this school. And here's a screen pass. Diagnosed beautifully by Nate Creer, the junior out of Brooklyn, New York, and there's nothing there. Rob Morshall caught the pass, and Creer was waiting for him, and somebody missed an assignment, and Texas looks like they haven't played a football game in about a month.
You know, they look rusty, don't they? Their execution seems to be lacking something, not quite sure exactly what it is.
Well, the fact of the matter is they haven't played a football game in a month, and I guess this is really what you expect teams to look like, Jack. I guess to get started here, both teams have been idle, as you indicated in our pregame report. Iowa's only played outside 3 or 4 times practice in preparation for this game. John Telschick will punt the ball from his 18-yard line, and Robert Smith is waiting, and Telschick gets off a boomer. It takes a Texas bounce inside the 30 or thereabouts and rolls dead at about the 28-yard line. Telschick has had himself one great season. That was a punt of 40 yards with no return. There's a timeout on the field. The score is still Iowa 7, Texas nothing. We'll be right back. Well, there you see the rain coming down here at Anaheim. Sam Nover and Jack Snow with the first Freedom Bowl, and framed very neatly between the scoreboard and the rain. The Goodyear blimp and our excellent shots of Anaheim being supplied by the Goodyear blimp, Columbia, with Captain Charles Russell at the controls. And we will periodically go to Captain Russell for some shots of this beautiful arena. Here's Long on first down, throwing the ball out of the right flat. It is caught for about a 7-yard gain. The catch is made by Bill Happel, the junior out of Cedar Rapids, Iowa, and the stop made immediately by Jerry Gray, the All-American free safety. So a gain of about 6 yards. It'll be second down and 4.
Look at Bill Happel there, number 40, as he leaves the field. That's his 40th catch this year. He's averaging about 13 and a half yards a catch. He's their ball control type receiver. He'll make that clutch catch, that intermediate catch.
So here they come again. Iowa now leading this football game 7-0. Split a receiver, Robert Smith, out wide to the left. He's the burner on the team. And the tight end, Jonathan Hayes, is split just a little bit to the right. And the pro set backfield, Owen Gill, gets the call. And he gets, he got close to the first down, but didn't make it. He may be a couple of yards shy as he crosses the 35 to about the 37-yard line. It'll be third down now for Iowa. Tony DeGrate, the Lombardi Trophy winner, is the man who made the stop. Big number 99, 6'4", 276 senior. Out of Snyder, Texas. And a delightful young man. Jack and I had a chance to talk at Texas practice the other day with both him and Jerry Gray. And Tony DeGrate has got a secret talent other than football, and that's portrait artist. And he can do a number. He's got all of his teammates standing in line to have their pictures done. Here's Long on third down, being chased out of the pocket now. He's going to try to run for it. And he got there. I believe he got the first down. He was chased on the far side by Ralph Darnell, the senior out of Mesquite, Texas. But I believe Long got enough yardage for the first down as he went across the 37-yard line. And Iowa will retain possession of the football, leading here 7-0.
Watch Long right here. He's a straight drop back pass. He's looking for Jonathan Hayes, number 34. He can't find him. He's pressured out of the pocket. Look at big 94 run. Big Ralph Darnell, 250 pounds, runs him out of bounds. Good hustle by 94, Ralph Darnell.
They spot the ball just shy of the 40-yard line, and Iowa now comes out in the pro set lineup. Receivers are split left and right. They lead here 7-0. And the give on a delay to Owen Gill, trying to get outside to the 45 and the 47-yard line of Jerry Gray. Comes up to make the stop, the consensus All-American out of Lubbock, Texas, 6'1", 189 pounds, and a lock to be a first-round draft choice. But sometimes it's got to appear to him, Jack, as if he's there all alone, and he is, at least as far as our cameraman was concerned.
You look at him here, number two. He recognizes very, very well. He likes to tackle. He likes to come up and stick you, and this is what he does so well here. He's got over 100 tackles so far this year. He's been compared very favorably with Johnny Johnson, the fine safety of the Los Angeles Rams. Gray says he's better. Johnson says, no, he's not. I'm better.
Only time will tell. From the 47-yard line, it is second down and three now for Iowa. They lead it 7-0 on a 6-yard touchdown pass from Chuck Long to Jonathan Hayes. And the give to the upback, Fred Bush, 6'1", 234-pound New Jersey native, and he gained a yard or two, stopped by Ralph Darnell. Jack, would you believe that Mr. Bush, who doesn't carry the ball very often, as his stats would indicate, once carried the ball in high school six times for 254 yards. If my math is any good, he averaged 62 and a half yards per carry.
If he was close to his playing weight of today, which is 234, I can certainly understand that too, Sam. Let me tell you, he's a great back though, but he's obviously a better blocker.
It is third down and two. And the partisan Iowa crowd trying to get their team going. They've got a few thousand people who came up here from Iowa City. And they've got a man wide open, the tight end on the far sideline, the 30. The 25, the 20, and out of bounds is Mike Flagg. And he was wide open. And Chuck Long spotted him on the far sideline in Iowa with another big first down. He was finally chased down by Ty Allert and Jerry Gray.
Texas is going to blitz on this play. You're going to watch Long right here. He's going to fake in here. Right now he notices, uh-oh, there's too many Longhorns in here. He sees flag number 86 out, running an out route, just a 5-yard sideline pattern. He gets the ball to him in a hurry, and now it's off to the races. But there's that man number two again, Jerry Gray. Look at it here. You see, there's 86 flag at the top of your screen. He beats the coverage right there, gets in behind the linebackers. Now you're going to see Gray come over here from the left of your screen. Right there, bam. Boy, does he put the wood to him. He and number 17, John Hagley, they both stick him.
But they did it 41 yards downfield, and Flagg will take that anytime. He'll take a shot like that for a 41-yard gain. Here's a give to Owen Gill, and he stacked up, forges forward to maybe the 11-yard line. Stopped there by Thomas Aldridge, number 97, and Jim Moore, number 75. The respective ends on this defensive front alignment now for Texas as Fred Akers has made some wholesale changes. He's taken McKinney and Brawner out. And trying to get some life now in the defensive unit of Texas, which is having problems stopping the Hawkeyes, although they didn't in the first two series. But once the offense gave them a second opportunity, Iowa scored, and they're about to do it again here with a second down at the 11-yard line.
Interesting, on defense, the only stat that where Texas is better than Iowa is in the secondary against pass defense, but right now that's exactly what's killing them.
Second down and nine from the 11, long play action pass. He delivers the ball in the end zone. Flag, touchdown, Iowa. And what will be sweet about that for Iowa is I think it came at the expense of the All-American free safety, Jerry Gray.
I think so. It looked like there was some coverage. You're going to watch it right here. Flag's going to come over right there from the left of your screen. He's going to head down. All of a sudden, Gray says, uh-oh, that's my man. I got to go get him. Unfortunately, good read by Long. He lays the ball up over the top of Gray. Great concentration by Flagg on that play, number 86. Again, another big target, 6'6", 245 pounds, and he's only a freshman.
So Tom Nichol will attempt to tack on the 14th point for the Hawkeyes here in the first quarter. 3:27 to play first quarter. It is now a 14-0 Iowa lead. And Fred Akers is going to have to reassemble his troops on the far sideline and get Texas organized. They are not accustomed to this kind of happening, yet they ended their season on a most sour note, their regular season, Jack. And there was some fear that this might carry over into the Freedom Bowl, and at least to start the game it has.
Well, they were beaten pretty handily by Texas A&M 37-12, and the week before that, Baylor got to them 24-10. And they're hoping to get that offense back in style and get things going, get the whole team on a winning way. But unfortunately, you know, you can't have the two fumbles that they've had, or the fumble and interception that kill you every time.
And the problem now, of course, is that Texas does not exactly have the kind of offense that plays catch-up football very well. And as I pointed out a moment ago, in their last six games, only once have they been over 15 points. And they need 15, obviously, to come back and have any chance in this ball game. And that's if they shut out Iowa the rest of the game.
Well, what they don't want to do, Texas doesn't want to do offensively, they don't want to panic, Sam. There's plenty of time. It's still only the first quarter with 3.5 minutes to go. What they want to do is get a nice controlled drive going, get some few runs in there, hit some ball control passes. They've got to get Dodge's confidence back up.
Tony Tillman, number 11, and Kelvin Epps, number 40, await this kick from Tom Nickel. It is a 14-0 Iowa lead. If you just joined us, it's the inaugural Freedom Bowl amidst the rain here in Anaheim, California. And we just had sensational day after day for the last 4 or 5 days. And wouldn't you know it, on game day, the rains came. And is obviously diminished and shrunken considerably the size of this crowd. Epps 5 yards deep in the end zone, downs the ball. It'll come back out to the 20, and Todd Dodge, as Jack has just indicated, will have to try to get something moving, develop a little continuity in the Texas offense. 72 yards, little over 3.5 minutes, 8 plays, and the touchdown pass to Flag. Of course, the big play in that drive was a 41-yarder to Flag down the sideline. So Chuck Long, after the first two series, has done about anything he's wanted to do here, Jack.
Surprisingly well. He's healthy at this stage. Everything seems to be operating very nicely, and he's not afraid to throw against Texas defense.
And the total yardage you saw there indicated. Texas now changing their tailback. Terry Orr is in there, number 37, along with Johnson in the backfield. And it's play action, Dodge on a rollout. And he keeps the ball and goes out of the 21-yard line. He simply ran out of real estate, running to the near sideline, and nobody was open. Mike Cooks and Jeff Drost had the pressure on him. It'll be a gain of about a yard. Second down and 9 now, as you look at Mr. Flagg on the sideline, very much enjoying his first trip to the Freedom Bowl. I don't know if it's first trip to California, but it's certainly his first trip out here to the Freedom Bowl.
He only had 6 catches coming into the ball game, so he's caught 2 already, 2 big ones, and his second touchdown of the season, so he's a very happy young man.
Well, Hayden Fry told us yesterday here he was concerned about the timing. His team was not executing very well at all, and they indicated that in their first 2 possessions, but they certainly have gotten their act together. The up back, Johnson, breaking across the 25 to the 26-yard line, stopped by Dross, number 76. And Jerome Johnson, the junior out of Pilot Point, Texas, is playing the first time this year without a cast on his right wrist. He broke his cast in the opening, he broke his wrist rather, in the opening game, and so he's got to feel a little bit free.
Watch the center right here, number 74, Chris Chilton. He's got to make that block, but great running by 35, Jerome Johnson. He gets past him there, gets upfield. He's keeping those shoulders north and south. He's heading straight upfield. He's not going from sideline to sideline. Good hard running.
It is 3rd down and 4 now for Texas, and Dodge drops back to pass, delivers the football, and it's caught at the 37-yard line. And that will be enough for a Texas first down, and the catch made by number 80, Bill Boy Bryant, the junior out of Dublin, Texas, 5'10", 153 pounds. And so Dodge completes his first pass of the day.
It's coming right at you. Now, if you're in the secondary, this is what it looks at. Looks like, plus if you're 30 feet tall. It's a curl route being run by Bill Boy Bryant. He makes a nice route. Knight comes back inside to meet the ball. It's a great pass by Dodge.
From the 36-yard line, the Longhorns trailing Iowa 14-0, the final seconds of the first quarter. And the give on a big hole up the middle of Terry Orr to midfield. He's at the 45, the 40, stiff arms a man, and goes out of bounds. And here come the Longhorns. Nate Creer with a saving tackle, but a big hole for number 37, Terry Orr. ...25 yards on the scamper by Orr.
He's averaging 4.6. It's a cut back. You start off to your right, you give your fullback the ball. Look at that. Nice runner right now. Creer in 29. He doesn't expect to see him. He turns his back one way, comes back around. All of a sudden, oh my goodness, there he is, 37, Terry Orr. I got to bring him down.
Yeah, and I hate to single out anybody, but Rick Schmidt had him right in his sights, and Orr put a fake on him. And Schmidt has replaced Devon Mitchell here in the starting lineup, and we indicated at the opening of our telecast, as The catch is made by number 95, William Harris, for short yardage. We mentioned the fact that if Devon Mitchell could not play, Jack, and Schmidt had to play, they would lose not only considerable experience, but perhaps considerable talent.
Well, they're going to lose some athletic ability. There's no question of that, Sam. I know Rick Schmidt, he's really in there. He really wants to give it his best. He's only a sophomore. He probably hasn't played a whole lot this year. So he's got to do the best he can do. His reads have got to be excellent. He's got to drop back in the secondary. But the most important thing is when he tackles, he's got to make the tackle. There's Akers. That's the coach's son.
Who is the backup quarterback here? And there is a momentary timeout on the field with a ball spotted just inside the 35-yard line. It'll be second down and six now for Texas with the clock showing. Well, I'm looking for time on the clock. We got anything left?
I think it's a minute and 38 seconds.
All right, I couldn't even find it over there. So they've taken a timeout here. Fred Akers has not exactly had a blessed experience in bowl games. He is 2-5-0 in the bowl games that he has played. And, of course, Texas has had a great deal of difficulty in turning the football over. They have a plus-minus of a minus 18 this year, which means they've given the ball away 18 more times than they've recovered it or intercepted it. And as a result, it's created a lot of gray hairs for that head coach, Fred Akers. Let's pause 5 seconds for station identification. This is the TCS Metro Sports Television Network.
KCRG, TV9, Cedar Rapids, Waterloo, Iowa.
Minute 38 to play first quarter. Sam Nover, Jack Snow at the Big A in Anaheim, California, the inaugural Freedom Bowl. And an excellent matchup. Two outstanding football programs, although they both faltered somewhat late in their respective seasons. Texas had an eye on the Cotton Bowl, Iowa the Rose Bowl. Neither achieved it, but both are glad to be here as Dodge flings it downfield, and it is broken up at the goal line. Bill Boyd Bryant, the intended receiver, and Nate Freer broke it up.
Well, I'll tell you what, that was mighty close, because Bill Boyd Bryant, number 80, he had Freer beat by a step or two. We're going to watch it again here. Dodge is going to drop back, set up now. He's reading, now release the ball. Creer gets beat to the inside. Bill Boyd beats him pretty. And here comes Creer, comes in at the last minute, gets that hand up in the face, and just gets his hand on the ball to break the receiver's concentration. Excellent job by 29, Nate Creer.
So it's third down and six now for Texas, and they split Bobby Duhon wide to the left, and Bill Boyd Bryant is in the slot to the left. They have a wing on the right side. And here's Todd Dodge rolling to the right. Delivers a ball. It's caught at the 27-yard line. And William Harris, the big tight end, made the catch, and he's fighting there with George Davis, the sophomore linebacker. And let's see where they spot the ball. I believe if they give him his forward progress, Jack, he's got a first down.
That's right. You got to stop. You got to spot the ball exactly where he stopped. He did a good job, William Harris, 95. He ran right into George Davis, gave a little step to the outside. We're going to see it here. You watch Dodd here drop back. He's looking for Harris all the way now. He sees him. He comes off his fake to the outside, comes back inside, and bam, then he gets stuck here by George Davis. He's a tough guy to bring down, Harris is. 6'5", 235 pounds.
And they bring the sticks in all the way from the other side of the field for a measurement. So we'll just hold it here, and it is a first down. So the leading receiver of the Texas Longhorns with a big catch there, Fred Akers on the sideline, now juggling his people, telling Terry Orr what play he wants here in a first down situation. It's 14-0 Iowa. If you just joined us, they have scored on two touchdown passes by Chuck Long, one of 6 yards to Jonathan Hayes, one of 11 yards to Mike Flagg. Tom Nicholas converted twice. Orr is in the backfield, number 37, with Jerome Johnson, number 35. They run out of the I formation. And the give is to Orr as he gets to about the 22-yard line, a gain of 5, and he stopped right there. It'll be second down and 5. Larry Station getting up from the bottom of the pile. Iowa's defense this year led the Big Ten in 4 categories versus the rush, only 100 yards per game, against the pass, only 150 yards per game, in total defense and in scoring defense, limiting their opponents to a little over 15 points a game. Russell Hayes is in. Bobby Duhon is up. It is second down and 5 now. Todd Dodge on a keeper, trying to get outside, cuts it up at the 20, slides at the 15, and gets the first down at about the 13. As he slides right in front of Rick Schmidt, the free safety, number 11, and it's another Texas first down.
Dodge is a good athlete. I think everybody's in agreement in that. He can do a lot of things well. The only thing he may lack is a strict passing ability, but oftentimes you can compensate for that by plays exactly like that. Dodge can do that. I don't think Long from Iowa can. He's not that type of runner. Dodge is an excellent athlete. Not a big guy, 5'11", 175, 178 pounds, but does a lot of things well. If he's on, as we said, he's tough.
Well, they'll have a chance to talk with Fred Akers here and decide about their first down situation. They are at the 13-yard line of Iowa. We have come to the end of the first quarter from the Big E in Anaheim, the Freedom Bowl. Iowa leads Texas 14-0. We'll be right back after this. The rain continues to fall here at the Big A in Anaheim as you take a look at our stadium and our football game from the Goodyear Blimp Columbia. It is first down and 10 to go. Texas trailing Iowa 14-0. Sam Nover and Jack Snow. Nice to have you with us. TCS Metro Sports happy to bring you the first ever Freedom Bowl. And Todd Dodge scrambling for about a yard to the 12-yard line. He did not fool anybody on that play at all, Jack.
Thought it might have been maybe a bad exchange in there between he and the center, but he kept hold of the ball very nicely, missed the handoff, and then got all he could and picked up a yard or two.
So it's second down and 9 now, Texas, with a golden opportunity to get right back in the game. And you see the total yards, rather surprising. Texas having moved the ball in this last drive. But at one point, they were out distance in yardage 93 to 33, and they have come back with some unanswered yardage here now and have a chance to put it in the end zone. Dodge has the I formation. Johnson, the up back, and Terry Orr, the deep back, and Orr gets the call and gets a couple of tough yards to the 10. He is tripped up by number 77, George Little, and Mike Hooks made the tackle secure at the 10-yard line. So Iowa's defense, number one in the Big Ten against the rush, starting to exert itself now. It'll be third down and about 7 for the Longhorns, trailing 14-0.
Longhorns have a good drive going. They started on their own 20-yard line. They're about 57, 58 yards so far with still having the ball, and that's a good sign. That's a real good sign.
But here's the play that he needs, Dodge to keep the drive alive. And Iowa's blitzing, Dodge rolling out to the right. Looking downfield, throws the ball, and it is touchdown, Texas! Bill Boy Bryant with a great sliding catch right at the flag. And the Longhorns are on the scoreboard.
Watch him right here. Now he's going to roll out, get in behind those big fullback and tailbacks and use them as extra blockers. This is a great pass. It's low and outside. Now watch where the ball is placed right here. The only thing that can happen is the receiver makes a catch, which he does. Fantastic catch. Watch it again right here. This is one of the greatest passes you'll ever see. Not a tight spiral, but the location is absolutely beautiful. There he is, Bill Boy Bryant, 5'10", 153-pound junior flanker.
That's his fourth touchdown catch of the year. Jeff Ward's extra point is up, and it is good. So now we have a football game. It didn't appear for a while in the first quarter as if we'd have a competitive game, but the Longhorns have gotten the kinks out, and they now trail Iowa 14-7. We'll be back after this. Back at the Big A in Anaheim, 14-7 Iowa. After Texas marched 80 yards to score the touchdown, Kerry Burt, number 6, and number 2, Robert Smith, in the deep receiving spots. You look at the young man who made the great pass, Todd Dodge, seated next to the young man who made the great catch, as Jack Snow called it, Bill Boy Bryant. Jeff Ward has the ball on the kicking tee, and we're about set now for this kickoff. Early second quarter, if you just joined us from Anaheim, the inaugural Freedom Bowl, and it's 14-7 the Hawkeyes. Is the guy they'd like to get their hands on the ball, but it's Kerry Burt at the 5 to the 20, and he is wrestled down at the 23-yard line. I think the ball came loose, but it may have come after the whistle. Texas indicates they have the football, but I don't believe it'll be allowed. Or will it? No, it'll be Iowa football, and they will begin at their own 23-yard line. Number 17, John Hagee, is the man who made the tackle of the 23. So here comes Iowa now. They're going to have to get their motor revved up again.
Look at that scoring drive. 80 yards, 4 minutes, 52 seconds. That's excellent. A long drive, and they took almost 5 minutes off the clock. 12 plays, 5 passes and 7 rushes. Most of those passes completed. Excellent job by the quarterback, Todd Dodge.
So here come the Hawkeyes now trying to do something about it. It's 14-7. They still have the lead. On first down, Long throws the ball across the field to the 35-yard line. The catch is made. There's a first down to the 40. And he was wide open. The reception made by Bill Happel, number 40, the junior out of Cedar Rapids, Iowa. Stephen Braggs and Tony Griffin combined to make the stop, but Long is really doing almost anything he wants offensively here.
He's getting good pass protection from that front 5 up there. Watch it right here. He's going to roll out to his right slightly. He's going to come back weak side now, allow Happel to come from the right side of your screen. He's running a square in pattern of about 14, 15 yards. Look at that. Nice route. Gets hit there by 16, Tony Griffin, who tries to bulldog him down.
They're just shy of the 40-yard line. First down, and Long wants to throw it again. He's doing a lot of rolling. Throws the home run ball downfield, and it's overthrown at the 20-yard line. That was intended for the burner, Robert Smith, at the 20. And Long just overthrew him, but Chucky Long is making it a lot easier for his offensive line. Jack, we had mentioned at the outset that they have offensive line problems, and the rollout gives him more time.
Well, it's good job by the Iowa offensive coordinator, Bill Snyder. What he's doing is he's having Long roll out to his right. Those linemen, those guards are pulling. The defense is flowing that way. The play before last, he brought his wide receiver, Happel, on a square, and this time he sent number two, Robert Smith, on a deep post to try to come back and work on 16, Tony Griffin.
Scott Helverson is split wide to the left now on second down and 10 from just shy of the 40. And Long, with a short drop, delivers the ball in an out pattern. Helverson's got it, and he's got the first down as he breaks down the sideline and breaks the tackle at the 35, the 30, and out of bounds. He broke the tackle of Tony Griffin, and it took Stephen Braggs to make the saving stop at about the 30-yard line, or else Iowa would be on the board again.
Watch it right here. Straight drop back now. No finesse. He just drills that ball right out there. You look at number 87 right there, Scott Helverson. Now watch right here. 16, Griffin should make the tackle, but doesn't. Helverson stays inbounds, and all of a sudden, boom, he gets smacked right there. Knocked out of bounds by good pursuit. What here? Bragg come over, number six. Look at it right here now. Makes a catch. Good concentration by Helverson. Keeps his feet going, turns upfield. And there's number six, Stephen Bragg, comes in to make a very key tackle.
29 yards on the play. Here is a delay now. The give to the running back inside the 30 to about the 29. Owen Gill, the ball carrier, runs right into Tony DeGreat, the big All-American, number 99, a gain of a yard, maybe two on the play. It'll be second down and 8, Iowa, as they tried to cross him up. Chuck Long is, well, what can I tell you about him? 6'4", 202-pound junior out of Wheaton, Illinois. He's a terrific young man, is really what he is. Very dedicated to his family. Has an extra year of eligibility if he so selects. Because of a ruling, he didn't play much in his freshman year, so in eligibility terms, he's a junior. His class will graduate this year, and he may very well if he's a first-round draft choice, and I think most people expect him to be. Rolling to his right, throws it right on target, the first down to the 16-yard line. And that is another Iowa first down. Lott is the man who made the stop. The catch made there by Rick Bayless, I believe, out of the backfield, number 13.
Watch Bayless right there. He sneaks out of the backfield, runs a little flat route. Long's rolling right to the side he is at. So they've got perfect concentration all the way between the two of them. Long can see him. Lays the ball out there to 13. Skip Bayless to walk on. Nice route, nice pass, nice catch.
And not so nice in terms of the field. I guess Bayless being helped out. June James and Lott made him pay for it. But it is another first down for the Iowa Hawkeyes. And now Mr. Long is 7 out of 12 for 124 yards throwing the ball and two touchdowns. And we haven't even reached the 11-minute mark in the second quarter. And he's throwing again. Throws the ball. It's caught. Out of bounds inside the 10. Mike Flagg, number 86, having the football game of his life, Jack Snow.
Absolutely. Great fingertip catch by 86, Mike Flagg. We're going to watch it again here now. Again, they're picking on number 16, Tony Griffin. Flagg, you just see him cross your screen right there. Watch the catch he makes right here. Look at that. Right out there, pulls that old ball right in. Nothing to it but to do it. And gets wrestled out of bounds by number 16, Tony Griffin. We might add, though, that Griffin is only a freshman, so they're picking on a youngster.
Gain of 7 on the... How many yards did they see? They've got second down up there. It is gain of 8, second down and 2. Couldn't find the end of the chains. Here's a pitch back now to the running back, Owen Gill, and he gets back to about the 9-yard line. His great penetration was made by that Texas defense. Stephen Braggs came on the blitz and really spoiled the play.
Braggs, you look at him, number 6, he makes a tackle. You're going to watch it again here. 85, Blake Bronner, the defensive end, comes in here and forces it. Boom, he gets stuck right there. There's Bronner right there. Comes boom, and there's number 6, Stephen Bragg. Good job by the Texas defense. Something unusual, too, Sam. We haven't seen that option play by Iowa yet this ball game.
Yeah, we might not see it again.
You're absolutely right. The way that worked, that's probably they'll can that one.
Third down and 3. They have the ball right at the 10-yard line, leading 14-7. Early moment, second quarter. Chuck Long, play action pass. Now rolling to his right, he's got it himself. At the 10, fumbles it out of bounds, and I think he fumbled it to first down yardage at the 5-yard line. I know he did. How about that for a break for the Hawkeyes? June James
had him in his sights, wrapped his arms around him, but Long lost control of the ball, and it bounced right out of bounds.
Big break for the Hawkeyes. There's no question of that, because it was really smacked pretty good by June James. The ball was smacked. That's what caused it to pop loose. Look at him right here. Watch everybody kind of hold. Nobody knows where the ball is for a moment here. And all of a sudden, Long takes out, and there's 62, June James. Now watch him as he reaches around right here and pops the ball. Good job there by June James.
A great job. He's a young man with 4'5 speed, 6'3, 221 pounds, and a senior who is expecting to be drafted by the NFL and USFL. So it's first and goal for the Hawkeyes. He could not, however, prevent Chuck Long from fumbling that ball to the first down. Here's a give to Bush straight ahead to the one-yard line. And the big fullback, a surprise ball carrier in that situation, gets the ball to the one or the two. Braggs and Griffin throw him back. It'll be second down and goal to go Iowa.
You got to give the offensive line of Iowa, Mark Singlinger, the offensive center, Kelly O'Brien, Bill Glass, those five interior linemen, Herb Wester and Mike Haight, they're doing a great job in there. You're going to watch it again here. What, just nothing fancy. He just comes in off the block of his fullback or his right guard, and boom, heads right up the field. He almost gets across the field, doesn't quite make it.
And a dive play, touchdown Iowa. Diving for the touchdown was, I believe, Eddie Polite, number 26. Let's see who had the ball. Was it Polite? I believe it was. Yes, sir. So they get the touchdown out of, or Bush was it?
I think it was Fred Bush. I think it might have been Fred Bush.
Polite maybe the lead block. Bush the touchdown. It happened quickly as they went on a quick count. Long just turned, gave it to Bush, who went in behind Polite. They both got in there. Either one of them could have scored.
That's right. Polite is a good blocker. He comes off the ball real well, leads the ball carrier Fred Bush into the hole, takes out the defender. Bush follows in, touchdown Iowa.
And so Tom Nichol now will attempt to tack on the 21st point. And so Iowa, having scored fairly well at will here in the first quarter and a half of this football game, taking a 21-7 lead with a conversion. There's a placement. The kick is up. And it is good. So there's a timeout on the field, and the score is now the Iowa Hawkeyes 21, the Texas Longhorns 7. We'll be back. Don't forget to join us for the TCS Metro Sports telecast in the Aloha Bowl, December 29th, 8 o'clock Eastern Time, when the Fighting Irish of Notre Dame meet the Southern Methodist Mustangs on the TCS Metro Sports Network. We invite you to check your local listings for the station in your area. You will be jetting out of here pretty soon, Mr. Snope, for that ball game along with Harry Callis, won't you?
We thought we'd get some sun, but I'll tell you what, there's probably no more sun over there in Honolulu than there is here in Anaheim.
Yeah, don't bet on it. I get the rain in Anaheim, and you and Callis get the 85-degree weather in Honolulu.
It's
right?
A dirty job, Sam, but somebody's got to do it.
Yeah, boy, well, I'll let you walk right into that one, didn't I, Jeff? So here we go now. Tom Nichol with a 21-7 lead, and the Hawkeyes kicking off Calvin Epps and Tony Tillman. And it is Epps 5 yards deep in the end zone. He wisely elects to down it. And Todd Dodge, who showed a great deal of character on an excellent 80-yard drive following Iowa's last touchdown, or the one before the last one, will have to do it again to get Texas right back in this game again. They trailed 21-7. And let's see what Fred Akers has up his sleeve. He's got to be concerned, Jack Snow, about the fact that his team gave up 61 points in the last two games that they played and lost, and they've given up 21 already here.
Yeah, there's no question that. They left on a sour note, but what they've got to do is they've got to reestablish their offense. They've got to get a little bit more consistent on defense, too, and shut down Long.
So here we go. Orr in the backfield, the pro set, along with Jerome Johnson. Now Orr goes in motion. They have not shown us motion very much from a running back today. Johnson gets the call for 10, 15, 20, 25, and almost 30 yards. So here they come with the big fullback, Jerome Johnson, busting it right up the middle. Mike Stoops with a tackle, number 41, but a big play on first down for the Longhorns.
Watch it right here. You're going to see 35, Jerome Johnson from the end zone. He's going to jump inside there. Now watch him make a break to his right. Puts a good move on Rick Schmidt, number 11. Now he heads outside, tries to pick up his blocking on 14, Russell Hayes. Jumps inside, and Stoops comes over 41 and makes the tackle. Another big play by Mike Stoops.
Boy, if you call that a good move, you must have had better moves than Crazy Legs Hurst.
But he's the only
that was one of the greatest moves I've ever seen in my life.
Well, not bad for a 220-pounder.
Yeah. First down at the 48-yard line, 28 yards on the jaunt. Here's Dodge. Moving around, throws the home run ball downfield, and it is incomplete. He had a man wide open.
Russell Hayes had that ball, I'll tell you that. Ball was right in his hand. He just couldn't come up with it. Great pass by Dodge.
Well, Dodge scrambled around, found a man wide open, and here it is again. Todd Dodge will have Russell Hayes in his sights, but they just cannot hook up.
Looks like he's going to take off upfield and run, but he pulls up at the last minute because he sees Hayes, who's running a post pattern all alone. Now watch the concentration. Let's see if he should make the catch. The ball's right there on the money. He comes down with it. He has it on the way down, but he just can't pull it in. Good effort, though. This is a great shot right here. Look at this. Oh, absolutely fantastic shot. He never does have control of the ball. That helmet's got to follow that ball all the way into the hands.
So it goes as a long, incompleted pass, and the Iowa partisans sigh a little bit here as Dodge now in the sights of the defense of Iowa and brought down at the 42-yard line. He could not escape that time. Bruce Gear, number 94, and George Little, 77, and takes a big loss back to the 42-yard line. So Dodge should have had a touchdown, ends up with a 6-yard loss and a third down and 16. Are you of the opinion, as many people are, Jack, that if a receiver gets his hands on the ball, he should catch it?
Well, most times you should. And the secret to catching the ball is only one thing. It's concentration. Watching that ball all the way into your hands. You're going to drop something. There's no question of that. But when you get wide open like that, or as wide open as he was, as Hayes was, that's a big play, the big time in the ball game. You've got to come down with it and make the catch.
Third down and 16, and Dodge has his hands full here. Here they come on the blitz, steps up in the pocket. Delivers a football. He's got a man. First down. He's got Bill Boy Bryant at the 32-yard line in Texas with a big play on third and 16. And it's been Bryant today and not Duham that Todd Dodge is going to.
Dodge is looking all the way for Bill Boy Bryant right here. He lays the ball out real nice. It's a great, great out route that Bill Boy runs. Now let's see if he gets 1 foot inbounds. There you go. He gets two inbounds. Piece of cake. No problem. Look at it again right here. He lays the ball right out there for him. He lays it away from the defensive back into the sideline, lets Bryant run over to the ball, make the catch.
And it's Keith Hunter whom he turned around on that play, the cornerback on the left side. So a first down from the 31-yard line, and here's a big hole for Terry Orr, the 25 to the 23. And this game now has really turned into an offensive football game. We thought we might see a 14-7 game. It's already 21-7, midway through the second quarter, and Texas is driving again.
Look at it right here now. He's going to roll out. There's going to be a cutback play right here to 37 Orr. Boom, he just gets away right there from number 91. Almost makes a tackle. Mike Hooks heads upfield. Look at Orr right here. 6'3", 231 pounds. Well, that's a lot. That's a load, as we say in the game. To get ahead of steam going, that's tough to bring down.
It is second down and 3 now for Texas inside the 25-yard line of Iowa. Todd Dodge gives to Orr again as he dives and stretches out to the 21. Stopped at the bottom there by number 77, George Little, who's had an outstanding year. Senior out of Duquesne, Pennsylvania. 6'4", 254 pounds. And he will be very close to another Texas first down. They may have to bring the sticks in here to measure. But it's for sure that the Longhorns have finally got on track. They trail 21-7, but a score here will get them right back in the football game again.
Absolutely. The thing that's interesting is the knock on Dodge, the quarterback, is sometimes the way he throws the ball. You know, the nose may be up or the nose may be down. Hey, who cares? As long as that ball is there and it's on the money, you don't care how it's thrown, as long as it gets there.
It is third down and less than a yard, and I believe the Texas has called for a timeout. Todd Dodge has called a timeout here, so on third and less than a yard, the Longhorns will talk it over. We have 7.5 minutes to play second quarter, and Iowa leads Texas 21-7. It's the first Freedom Bowl. There's a good shot of our captain, Charles Russell, aboard the Goodyear Blimp Columbia, and providing us with the excellent shots here of Anaheim, the Big A, and the Texas-Iowa Freedom Bowl clash. It is third down and less than a yard. And they give straight ahead on a quick opener. Johnson inside the 10, first down, goal to go, the Longhorns. Nate Creer, number 29, and Keith Hunter, number 14, made the stop. But it so often happens in very short yardage situations, once a running back is able to break the line of scrimmage, it is clear sailing, and it almost was that time for Johnson to the end zone.
It's a great trap block, too, by the left guard, number 59, Billy Ray Todd. He did an excellent job on Jeff Gross, the nose tackle for Iowa.
So it's first down and 7 to go now for the touchdown for Texas, and Todd Dodge has directed another great drive. Play action pass, throws it in the end zone, and it's overthrown. Intended there for the tight end, Harris, number 95. He's looking around for an interference call, and he was the only Texas receiver in the end zone. He was accompanied there by three or four of the defensive unit of the Iowa Hawkeyes. It'll be second down and 7, and the clock stops. 7:07 to play here in the second quarter.
You know, Sam, we saw them working on that play when we were out at the practice a couple days ago. There's no question. They only put the one receiver out, and the idea is to hold everybody else with the play action fake into your backs, get them to take a step up and slip that tight end in behind him. And unfortunately, it did not work for him.
They got the power eye formation this time with Ronnie Robinson, Jerome Johnson, and Terry Orr. And the give is to the running back inside the 5 to the 3 yard line. It's Michael Brown, I beg your pardon, number 27 instead of Orr 37. And Brown to about the 3 yard line. It'll be third down and goal to go Texas at the 3 yard line. Now, I ask you, is that not a strange situation to put a fresh back into when you're first and goal at the 7 and you bring in a guy who hasn't played in the entire ball game? I'm not criticizing. I'm only questioning the Fred Aiken.
You are too. You're criticizing. No, I think I agree with you.
When I criticize, you'll know it, Jack.
I agree with you. You wonder why when Orr's been doing such a great job as a ball carrier. He's a much bigger guy.
But they've got Brown there now in the power eye. He's got two big fullbacks in front of him. He sends Robinson in motion. It's third down, and they ask Brown to do it again. He cuts it up at the 5, and he squirms to the goal line. I don't believe he got in, but he made a great second effort.
He's close. No question of that. He's very close.
5'11", 200-pound senior out of Dallas, Texas, fourth down, and if he didn't make it, and he did not, he is only inches away.
He's going to have the big horses blocking up front for him. 35, Jerome Johnson, and 37, Terry Orr. Watch him put his head down and try to crack the plane of that goal. He sticks in there so hard, he loses his helmet. There's a little bit of contact going on down there.
And he carried Kevin Spitzig, the linebacker, right to the goal line. I like this move. So maybe Akers did know what he was doing here. It is fourth down and goal to go, and there's no question Texas is going to go for it. They trail 21-7. 6:45 to go here in the second quarter, and they need this touchdown now to get back in the game. Power eye. Dodge rolling out, throws it wide open. Touchdown to Harris. What a great call by Akers. On fourth and goal at the half-yard line, the Longhorns get the touchdown.
Man, that's a gutsy call, I'll tell you, because they sent him out to the right all by himself, and he could have gotten eaten up very easily by the left side of the line. Watch it right here. It's a fake going to the one way, and here he comes out in the naked reverse by himself. You see 95, Harris slip right in behind the linebackers. There he is, wide open for the touchdown. Good catch. Great call.
And so Jeff Ward will attempt the extra point. It is now 21-13, the placement by Morshell, and the kick is up, and it is good. Funny at practice, I asked Jeff Ward, he's got a backup holder, and he said if Rob Morshell can't hold for him, he's getting out of the kicking business. That's how important his holder is to him. So it's 21-14, Iowa. We've got an excellent football game, and we're delighted you're with us here in the rain at Anaheim. We'll be back after this. With former Los Angeles Rams star receiver Jack Snow, this is Sam Nover at the Big A in Anaheim, California. It is 21-14. Texas has just scored to get back to within 7. We have 5.5 minutes to play here in the second quarter, and the rain continues to fall in Anaheim. It is the inaugural Freedom Bowl, matching these two outstanding football programs, and the story has been well chronicled. Texas had hoped to be in the Cotton Bowl on New Year's Day, and they had the inside track till they lost a couple of football games, namely to Baylor and A&M. And Iowa had hoped to be in the Rose Bowl till they lost a couple of games, namely to Michigan State and Minnesota. Here's a return to the 20. The 25 getting outside is Robert Smith and out of bounds, shy of the 30-yard line. So he took the kick by Jeff Ward and returned it near the 30-yard line. He was run out by Tony Tillman, number 11.
There he is, Harris, the tight end. Look at the steam come off him.
And it's not because he's mad, right?
80 yards. Again, another long drive, 4 minutes and 40 seconds, 11 plays. Again, 4 key passes. The key pass naturally dodged to Harris for the 1 yard touchdown. Gutsy call, great execution.
5th touchdown reception of the year for the big tight end Harris. So here comes Iowa now, and they spot the ball at the 26 yard line. Let's see what Chuck Long does here. He's done most of what he's wanted to do here in the first half. From his 26, he's back to pass. Over the middle, caught by Bill Happel. At about the 30-yard line, he's hit instantly by James Lott, the 6'1 sophomore out of Refugio, Texas. And he happens to be a world-class high jumper, does Mr. Lott. He has high jumped 7'5 in his life.
Watch Apple 40. It's just a delay, inside delay. He waits for his inside receiver to clear the route. Then he makes it a little 5, 6, 8-yard square in. He's knocked down by number 9, James Lott.
They pick on Lott a lot, Jack. You know that. No pun intended, picking on Lott a lot, but they have during the course of this year. And it's been his inexperience, but he certainly is a very gifted athlete. Eric Jeffries now in the secondary, number 1. And the give on an inside handoff, and Texas was not fooled. Not fooled at all. Big number 68, Bill Hethcock, was there to make the stop, the senior out of Garland, Texas. And for a loss, back to the 27-yard line.
Take a look at it right here. It's just a little quick trap. You try to catch him off ground right here. You hand the ball off to Owen Gill, 33, and tries to pop inside. He can't do a real good job because of Heathcock, who plays it very, very well.
So Iowa now, losing some of its momentum, has a third down and 9 at its own 27-yard line. And certainly if they have to give the ball up here, it'll give Texas another great opportunity to get the ball back into the end zone before halftime. 5 defensive backs by the Longhorns. Everybody in the building knows what's coming here on 3rd and 9. Helverson in motion. Long fumbles the ball, picks it up, and got a yard or two, but he bobbled a snap from the center, Mark Sindlinger. And Jim Moore fell on him, and now they say Texas has the ball.
Did Heathcock recover that fumble? Another 2 big plays back-to-back. Let's watch right here and see if there's it. Oh, there's never any control by the quarterback from his snap from the center. Looks like he has it right here, but then he drops it. Heathcock, 68, is going to come right in there and sneak in there and pull the ball away for Texas.
And Chucky Long made a drastic mistake by trying to pick it up and move it instead of just plopping on the ball, Jack.
Heathcock's a bandit. He just snuck his hands in there and snuck that ball right away from the quarterback, Chuck Long.
So look what's happened here. Trailing at 1 point, 21-7 and 14-0 before that. The Longhorns now have a first down at Iowa's 27-yard line, a chance to get even. But not on that play they won't, as Terry Orr ran right into the linebacker, the defensive lineman, Hap Peterson, number 50, and he stopped him right at the line of scrimmage. He just submarined the play, did the junior out of Bettendorf, Iowa, and Peterson knocked Orr right to the ground. No gain. It is 2nd down and 10 now for Texas. Time is not a factor. 3.5 minutes to play here in the first half, and Dodge is passing stats for the day. In motion, Bill Boy Bryant. Dodge has everybody around him in black and gold, and down he goes back at the 34. And again, it's Hap Peterson who just came into the lineup, Jack. And he certainly has made his presence felt.
Absolutely. Peterson came off the ball like a sprinter coming out of the blocks. He came right in. You're going to see it right here. You're going to see Dodge roll out to his left. And the first guy you're going to see right there coming from the left of your screen is number 50, Hap Peterson. Watch him. Puts on the brakes. Great job there by Hap Peterson. 6'2", 255-pound junior. Great ability, great agility.
And so far, great stand by the Hawkeyes as they brought around 3rd down. And let's call it 15, back at the 33-yard line. 3rd and 15 now for Texas. Dodge had a 3rd and 16 earlier and completed a 27-yard pass to Bryant. Let's see what he does here. He's wrapped up and tossed out of bounds with one hand by number 91, Mike Hooks. And so the Texas opportunity has gone down the drain, it would appear, on 4th down.
They had an opportunity to bring this ball game into a tie, 21-21 tie. He just couldn't get outside of number 91, Mike Hooks, on the rollout. You're going to see it again here. A little running fake here. Now he's going to roll out right now. He's looking downfield. He wants to go to 80. Bill Boy Bryant. He can't do that. Look at the job that 91 Mike Hooks does. Gets those big arms out there and pulls him out of bounds.
And Jeff Ward will attempt the field goal. Bobby Duhon will spot the ball at the 41-yard line. It'll be attempt of 51 yards. And on field goal attempt of over 50, Ward is 0-for-3 this year. The placement by Duhon. The kick by Ward is up. And it is no good. It is wide, and a flag is down, however. Let's see what this penalty marker is all about. A penalty flag is down at the 41-yard line. We may have roughing the kicker, and if we do, it'll be a great opportunity for Texas, and Iowa will have given the Longhorns another chance. Let's see.
Watch Ward right here. Legs extended. Let's see if he gets hit here by anyone from Iowa. Bam, ooh. He sure does. He gets smacked real good by Keith Hunter, number 14.
Mm.
Can't do that. Even if you get blocked in him, you can't hit that kicker because he's so vulnerable.
Nobody feels worse about it than the senior out of Newark, New Jersey, the starting left cornerback, Keith Hunter, 5'11", 200-pounder. And he's probably saying to his teammates, they hit me into him. I'm not supposed to run into him.
Well, you can't do that to those guys when they kick because they're just totally exposed. They have no protection whatsoever.
So Texas will not get the automatic first down, I don't believe, but they will get another chance for Ward from closer in. And they will try again. So Morshell will spot the ball now at the 36, and all of a sudden a 51-yard miss becomes translated into a 46-yard second attempt. And this certainly is most makeable. Morshell spots it. Ward kicks it. It's up. It is good. Given the second opportunity, Jeff Ward has converted on a 46-yard field goal, and it's a 21-17 Iowa lead.
Big comeback, big points on the board right now. At least they don't go away empty-handed. They had great field position. they come away with something rather than going away with nothing at all. Key play again, remember, was 14, Keith Hunter, the cornerback for Iowa, who ran into the kicker, Ward.
Well, you're absolutely right, Jack. Texas has to feel good about getting anything out of the drive after they were faced with third down at 15 and having failed on it. And they get the second opportunity, so it's 21-17 now. And Ward is going to place the ball on the kicking tee at the 40-yard line, and he will kick it to Kerry Burt and Robert Smith. We invite you to stay tuned at halftime for our halftime activities.
Jim Ward, 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 Ward.
We'll have highlights of the first half, and we'll have a nice close look at both the University of Iowa and the University of Texas and the statistics from the first half. Hello, Coach Allen. Oh, I'm glad you are. Coach George Allen has just walked into our booth. Jack, maybe you might want to chat with him for a second. I'll give up my headset. You
played a little bit for this man. Go ahead.
Coach, I want you to come in here now and do the play-by-play and call all the defensive signals for us. You're looking at a great ball game right here against two fine teams. Not a lot of defense, right?
Jack, I'd say that this guy Chuck Long is going to increase his value, but he looks like a true first-round pick. He may be the best quarterback in America, college quarterback.
Do you think he'll hurt himself or help himself if he stays for another year?
Well, I think probably he should. On the basis of what I've seen tonight and on his record, he can play in the National Football League. So that's the decision he has to make.
Right. He's got one more year of eligibility if he wants to take it.
He can do it all. I like his arm, and he's got leadership. My first coaching job was in the state of Iowa, Jack.
Right, Morningside, wasn't it?
Morningside College in Sioux City, and I'm taking a busman's holiday today.
You're seeing some great players, Coach. Thank you very much for stopping by.
Good luck, man.
Thank you very much, Coach.
Thanks, Coach.
Appreciate it very much. Jack Snow's a former coach, of course, with the Los Angeles Rams, and one of the most notable coaches in the history of this football game. You'll have to tell me all about him, Jack. Was he a good guy?
Great defensive coach, I'll tell you. There's
back to the action here. Better get back into the football game. Bill Happel with the catch, and Jeffries makes a stop up around the 34-yard line. Eric Jeffries is the man who made the stop. Gotta get my microphone repositioned here. Kind of took me by surprise. See George Allen in our booth all of a sudden. I guess that happens in the Tinseltown, doesn't it?
Watch it right here again now. Happel, number 40. As we said earlier, he's the ball control receiver. He comes in on another square in route, makes a nice catch, comes inside and pick up the first down.
Still from the 35-yard line. Here comes Iowa now. 21-17. The Hawkeyes are clinging tenaciously now to a four-point lead. They have a first down at their own 35-yard line and a minute 47 to play in the half. And you heard Coach Allen's remarks about Chuck Long. He certainly has performed admirably today. Throws it far side, caught by Robert Smith, and then dropped at the 45-yard line of Texas. I think he outsmarted himself. He didn't have anybody around there, and he felt compelled to jump for the ball.
Exactly. You're very observant, I'll tell you that, because that's one thing he did not have to do. I think we got a penalty flag down on the field. But the one thing that number two, Robert Smith, did not have to do, he was so wide open, just let the ball come in his hands.
We may have a roughing the passer here. Long is being talked to by his teammates. Let's see here.
Look at the release. Now watch number two, Robert Smith. He leaves his feet, goes up in the air. He does not have to do that. When you do that, you break the plane, the eye to ball plane, and then you have to do something that you're not accustomed to, and you can't make the catch.
That's exactly what it was, Jack. He was roughing the passer, unnecessary roughness against Texas. So Iowa, having made some foolish mistakes earlier in the ball game, now finds that the Texas Longhorns have done the same. And it's first down right on the 50-yard line. So Iowa with plenty of time to open up into at least a six-point lead and maybe a 10-point lead before halftime. Minute 38 to play, and Long sets him out with a receiver to the left and one to the right, and he's back to pass. A straight drop this time. Delivers the ball over the middle, and it is caught in a comeback pattern by Happel, who's having himself quite a day. The junior out of Cedar Rapids, number 40, gets another first down and stops the clock at the 38-yard line as they move the sticks.
I like Happel. I really like him. You know, the knock on him again is he doesn't have a lot of speed, but I'll tell you, he runs some great routes. You're going to look at it here. Now, if you're the defensive back, this is what you got coming at you. It makes you kind of nervous back there. Nice throw right there by Long. Notice Happel goes down on both knees and catches the ball with his body. Excellent job. Heads up thinking.
Fourth catch, 45 yards for Happel on the day. Here's Long again. And this one is caught and carried out of bounds to the near sideline is the receiver. And they stop the clock at the 33-yard line. That time it was the big tight end Mike Flagg, number 86. And the stop was made by Eric Jeffries, number one, as they used the five defensive backs on this drive. But the clock stopped with a minute 15 to play. And there you see Long stats on the day. And what a first half he's had. No wonder George Allen so excited about him.
Well, you know, when George walked into the booth, he scared the heck out of me because I thought, oh, I dropped the ball. I've done something wrong. And suddenly I realized, heck, I hadn't played for him in 10 years, so I couldn't have done anything wrong.
He looks terrific, doesn't he?
Yes, he does.
Kind of took me by surprise. I turned around and looked at our stage manager, John Grohol, and there's George Allen peering over his shoulder. It is now second down for Long. Looking downfield, throws it short again, and it's caught at the 27-yard line. And you understand now why this young man has had such an incredible... Uh-oh, somebody's hurt. Somebody's down right there. Smith gets up, and they call an immediate timeout. But seeing him throw so effectively, Jack, you now can appreciate the fact that he completes at a rate of 66%, the number one passer in America.
Exceptionally. Watch number 99 right here degrade. The reason he hadn't been putting a lot of pressure on is because of the fine job by 66, Kelly O'Brien, the right tackle, and the 56, Mark Singler. They've been doing an outstanding job. Look at him right here. They're coming off, keep the hands outstretched. Excellent job by the offensive line. Again, number 73 is in there doing a superb job, Herb Wester. Look at the ball thrown here to Robert Smith, number two, makes a nice catch in heavy traffic.
So Iowa has called a timeout here to stop the clock. For those who may be just only vaguely familiar with the name Chuck Long, the youngster has established an NCAA record. He did it against Indiana earlier this year of completing 22 consecutive passes. The previous record was held by Steve Young of Brigham Young. That was 18. But what an accomplishment. And you can see his pinpoint passing. Yes, he throws a lot of short things and a lot of underneath patterns, but he certainly has great accuracy.
He does. He's an excellent... I'm trying to read this right here.
Yeah, I am too.
Something about
Iowa. Lead a good life, yeah. Something will end up in Iowa.
Well, when you live in Iowa, there's no disrespect, but there's you do lead a good life if you live in Iowa. Not a lot to do there. It's a great part of the country, though.
I think quite to the contrary. I think you're being very respectful.
I have relatives that live in Iowa, and it's great. I visit them all the time. It's a great country.
From the 28-yard line now following the timeout, a minute one to play in the first half, and we have an excellent football game and most competitive. 21-17, the Hawkeyes lead Texas, and look at this. Well, did they draw big Mr. DeGrade offside? I believe they did. I mean, I believe that they... did not move, and Texas will be penalized here 5 yards.
DeGrade's getting a little bit frustrated now. He hasn't been able to get to the quarterback. He hasn't been able to get to Long. He's been double-teamed, and you get frustrated in a ball game when that happens to you. So what happens is you get a little antsy, and you move quicker than you should. You got to watch that ball, Tony, when the ball snap go.
Offside, Tony DeGrade, number 99 of Texas, although the officials don't tell you in college ball who it is. And it's an automatic first down. They did not have to run the play. So, and they didn't have, more importantly, Jack, they didn't lose any time off the clock.
That's right. The clock did not start. They still have, just about a minute or so to go in the
ball game. Right, in the first half.
First half, yes.
23-yard line. So here's Chuck Long now with four new downs and a little over a minute with which to get the ball in the end zone. Short drop, looks over the middle, short pass. In double coverage, it's caught inside the 20-yard line, and then the man is brought down to the turf. That may be the big tight end Mike Flagg again, and it is.
Flagg's having a great night, isn't he? Tough kid. Only a freshman, 6'6", 245 pounds, some key catches. It's a big night for him.
That is his seventh catch for 69 yards in the ball game. We've only played a half. What a receiver. What a receiver.
You look at Long right there, number 16. I tell you, the thing that makes him so great is he gets back in such a hurry. He sets up, he sees the entire field, and he just picks him apart.
Iowa's had to call another timeout, so they have but one remaining.
Watch right here, Long. He knows what's going on all over that field. He forces the ball in here. It's tight coverage, but it's a good catch by Flagg. And, boy, he does take a hit. Number two's right there. Jerry Gray really pops him. There's number nine, James Lott, comes in there and smacks him. Gray gets up there and says, I'm going to hit you again, and he does. Look at it right here. Just whip sidelines that three-quarter arms, that ball right into there.
We're not just talking about your normal senior quarterback or junior quarterback who could come out this year if he so desires. We're talking about a young man that most of the great football NFL scouts, Gil Brandt, the recruiting directors, scouting directors, Dick Steinberg in New England, say will be a first-round draft choice. He may go a little ahead of Doug Flutie. He may go a little behind him, but it's Long and Flutie in the first round, certainly of the NFL draft.
There's no question of that. If you look at pure physical talent, though, and that's what they may look at, you've got to go with Long because he's a bigger kid. And taking nothing away from Doug Flutie because Doug is an outstanding quarterback, and he'll be a good professional quarterback. They're two different types of quarterback. You have the pocket passer, which Long is, and you have the scrambler, which Flutie is. And they're both excellent in their own right.
Something just to look ahead to, Jack, and put in the back of your mind, is that if they go off leading by, they can't go off presumably leading by less than four. If they go off leading by 11, Iowa has outscored opponents in the third quarter 70-13. So their best quarter lies ahead.
That's scary if you're on Texas' side of the ball.
I would think so. Clock continues to run down as they run the ball into the center of the line. Jim Moore made the stop on Owen Gill. And why they ran the ball with only one timeout left, I do not know. They certainly, maybe they're just trying to position themselves for a field goal.
Exactly.
We are 15 seconds left. They're not using the clock very judiciously, the Iowa Hawkeyes. Now let's see what Long does. He delays again to Owen Gill. Running outside to the 11.
You better stop
they
that
better,
clock.
Yep. 4 seconds to go, and they stop the clock with their final timeout. Jerry Gray made the tackle, but they had a chance to throw it in the end zone a couple of times and elected not to.
That was a surprise because they had the ball right between the hash marks. What it means is, if they, you know, it's in perfect position for a field goal. What they didn't do is they took themselves out of position for the field goal because Gill run the ball clear across the field. It's going to be a heck of a shot right here for Tom Nickel now.
Nickel will have to kick it from the hash marks on the far side of the field. I think that's what you meant. They had the ball in the middle of the field and they run it outside. And so it won't be a very long kick for Nickel, but it'll be at a slight angle. See, this one will come. The line of scrimmage is what, about the 11-yard line, about the 18, a kick of 28 yards. And Nickel is 7 out of 8 this year inside the 29-yard line. So they'll have time for this one kick. The hold will come at the 27, at the 17, rather. It'll be an attempt of 27 yards by Tom Nickel, the senior out of Green Bay, Wisconsin.
Makes this kick, they may look at him in the draft because John Stenner is a great kicker, but he's getting a little bit up in age.
Well, let's see what happens here. Long will spot for him. There's a placement. The spot, the kick by Nickel is up, and it is perfect. So we end the first half on that note. A 27-yard field goal by Tom Nickel of the Iowa Hawkeyes. And it enables them to go off at halftime with a 7-point lead. And with these two great defensive units, it's hard to imagine. We've scored 41 points in the first half. It's 24-17, the Hawkeyes over the Longhorns. Our halftime activities here at the Freedom Bowl will begin right after this. More times for more yardage and more completions than any quarterback in Texas history. And it's true that they kind of rise and fall as per his performance, Jack.
That's true. You know, when you think of Texas for so long, it's been the wishbone. You run, you pass now and then once in a while. But Dodge, for what they've asked him to do, he's a scrapper. He's a fighter. He may not be as gifted as a Chuck Long physically, but I'll tell you, he's a tough competitor. He had a ball dropped on him in that first half that would have put Texas ahead had the receiver made the catch.
We joked earlier about the fact that both teams started out like two teams who hadn't played football in a month. The fact is, it's been almost a month
right.
since they played football. And both coaches were a little precarious and a little leery as to how their teams would perform early on in the ballgame. And it took them about a half a quarter to work out the kinks. But once they got it going, I thought both offensive machines performed well. And what really is utterly amazing is both head coaches were really concerned about their offensive line. How could you find anything fault with that?
That's right. For the last 2 days, we've been hearing about injuries. And, geez, we hope we can put our patchwork offensive line together and keep the opposition, the defense, out. But I swear to God, they've been doing a fantastic job.
What do you think Iowa has done in the first half that perhaps they hadn't planned on doing? And by that, I mean, I think Hayden Fry had a game plan, and when he saw that Long was throwing the ball so freely, he may have thrown it more than he had planned on doing it.
I think the one thing that Iowa did that they hadn't planned on was they took the ball out of Owen Gill's hands as a runner and put it into Chuck Long's hands as a passer and let him throw the ball.
Well, we'll see what happens, obviously, in the second half. We have more of our halftime activities following this, and we have perhaps a little bit more fireworks for you. We are at halftime of the Freedom Bowl with the Iowa Hawkeyes leading the Texas Longhorns 24-17. We'll continue in just a moment. The tunnel, here they come, just coming out of the tunnel now to our right and coming from the end zone. And as we look at the statistical sheet from the first half, anything jump out at you here, Jack Snow? I should make a correction. I think before halftime I gave Flag with 5 receptions. There were 7 rather. He had only 5 catches in the first half. And you look at the composite of the first half, and total yardage is about the same. Obviously, the Longhorns have rushed the ball much better than has Iowa. On the other hand, the Hawkeyes have thrown the daylights out of the football. And first downs are somewhat comparable. Time of possession somewhat comparable. There's not an imbalance there anywhere. Turnovers are...
I don't think there's anything there that jumps out at you and bites you and says, man, this is really one-sided. It's a pretty even game, and the score indicates that 24-17. The thing that I'm happy to see is Dodge, the quarterback. He's led a good Texas offense, and he has to come out the second half with a great deal of confidence.
And as I said before we left it, in the second quarter that the great thing that Iowa's got to look forward to and the thing that Texas might concern itself with, if past history is any indication, is the fact that these Hawkeyes come out and really play the daylights out of you in the third quarter. They have outscored their opposition in the third quarter this year 70-13, and with a seven-point lead, that would bode very well for their chances of winning this football game. And as I said at the outset, it was almost a pick'em game. Earlier on, it was Iowa favored by one, then it switched over to Texas favored by one, and I imagine the game time, it could have been anybody. So it was considered to be a very even Steven football game to start, and it's been pretty much that, although Iowa got off to the big lead early on and Texas had to play catch-up. But much to many people's surprise around the country, Texas played catch-up and did it with an offense that isn't really geared to do that.
Absolutely. That's a key point. They didn't panic. They didn't put themselves in a situation where they had a chance to give the ball up with erratic plays or erratic throwing. They played a good ball control offense, came back to get close.
And so, to start the second half, Texas now is on the field, and Iowa deploying, I believe, to receive the second half kickoff. And again, the rain has kind of dissipated just a bit, so it comes in spurts. Jeff Ward will kick off for Texas, and Iowa will send Robert Smith, number two, and Kerry Burt, number six, into the deep receiving spots. Iowa has not gotten the ball into the hands of Jonathan Hayes, perhaps, as much as I might have expected in the first half, Jack. He did catch the first touchdown pass, but he's kind of been absent after that.
Well, I think the reason he's been absent is because they've used Mike Flagg, his backup, number 86. Mike Flagg, the freshman tight end, is having just a fantastic night. You know, and that takes some of the pressure or some of the glitter away from Jonathan Hayes. Two good quality tight ends. They both can catch the ball. You know, and as long as you, obviously what's happening is Iowa is not hurting himself by having either one of them in there.
And they play them oftentimes together, and they have played double tight end situations an awful lot tonight. So here we go. Second half kickoff. Texas kicking to Iowa. The Hawkeyes lead it 24-17. 41 points scored in the first half. Under these conditions and with two great defensive units, we would not have suspected that. Kerry Burt reaches the 25, 30, and a flag is down. Back at the 20-yard line, and this would indicate a penalty against Iowa as he reached a 33. Gerard Senegal is the man who made the stop, but this may come back and force Chuck Long to begin very deep in his own territory.
Maybe a clipping call or hitting below the waist, illegal block, or may even be a holding call because it seemed like it was a delayed call. There's a lot of bodies tied up down in that area.
And so the Hawkeyes, now moving back toward their own goal line, will begin from very, very deep in their own territory, and they will start with Chuck Long at quarterback. They spot the ball at the 11-yard line. Referee is Jack Gato, and he indicates a clip against Iowa. Might see this one here, Jack.
Let's see if we can pick it up now. Right up. Top right-hand side of the screen. There you go, right there. Boom. The Texas defender can't get the numbers, but what happens is the Iowa Hawkeye comes in, hits him from the backside, pushes him past the ball. You can't do that. You got to have that head, that helmet in front, in the numbers.
So the Hawkeyes from their own 11-yard line to begin the second half. Their center is Sindlinger, and their offensive guards, Glass 58, O'Brien 66. They've got Wester 73 and Haight 79 at the tackles. And they begin here with a slot to the right. Long play action pass, looking over the middle, throws one downfield. He's got a man wide open at the 40. The 45, the 50, it's Jonathan Hayes, the man we were just talking about.
Like we said earlier, you know, you don't lose a step with either one of them. Hayes is probably the better deep receiver. He's probably got a little bit more speed than Mike Flagg. He's going to be running on number six, Stephen Braggs. Little play action to hold him, and it's just a one-on-one situation. Bragg, number six from Texas, lets Hayes get in behind him. Look at Hayes. Good concentration, big catch, heads off down the sideline, but Bragg does come over there and make the tackle. Going to look at it again here from the sideline view. Watch him lay that ball out. Watch Long lay the ball out there. Nice pass, good concentration. He follows the ball all the way into his hands. Here comes Bragg, number six, Stephen Braggs, to keep a touchdown.
What a way to start the second half. 49 yards, Long to Hayes. At the 39-yard line of Texas, here's Long again on a crossing pattern at the 29. And he's got Happel, I believe, number 40. And a flag goes down. Tony Griffin had him in his grasp. And there's a penalty marker, and he may have grabbed hold of that face mask in trying to wrestle him down. But look at Chucky Long. He comes out of firing here, and it is a face mask against Texas.
That's frustration on the defensive back. I think that was Tony Griffin who finally wound up making the tackle. We're going to see Happel again. Now, remember, as we said, he probably doesn't have the great speed as some of the outside people do, but he is a great ball control receiver.
Well, we continue to have problems, and we apologize for that with the referee's mic.
Long's going to roll out to his right like he did in the first half. Watch him come back. He's going to come back weak side. There's Happel, number 40. Good catch, good body catch with the defender hanging on him. Let's see if we can pick the, we can't pick it up there, but we know it does happen.
So it is first down and 10 to go Iowa now at the Texas 24-yard line. And Chuck Long is picking this Longhorn defense apart. Owen Gill for about a yard. He is dragged down by Jerry Gray, the outstanding senior free safety, number two, that we have talked so much about in setting up this football game. And sometimes it's just a lone voice back in that vast secondary, Jack Snow.
Well, he patrols it with such adeptness. I mean, he's a gifted athlete. He's got great speed. He reacts well. It looks like watching him play this, it looks like he likes to react to the run. There's Owen Gill right there. So he's having a great day considering all the things that are wrong with him. An injured neck, a bad back, kidney problems that he's has Bruce. He's playing very well this evening.
Gain of one, second down and nine. Bayless is in there now, running back, and five backs being used by Texas. Long stepping up in the pocket, throws a flare, and I think he threw it away. Intended the ball for Bayless out of the right flat at about the 16-yard line, but Bayless was well covered there by June James, and so it's an incompleted pass, stopping the clock, and setting up third down and nine now. So in nothing flat, Iowa moved from its own 11 to the 24-yard line of Texas in two plays, and now they're faced with a third down.
That was a good play by 62, June James. Remember, in the first half, they ran the same thing. They brought Bayless out of the backfield about 5 to 8 yards downfield, ran him towards the sideline, and he beat June James. This time, James was sitting there waiting for him. That's what makes James a good linebacker. You beat me once, it's okay, but you're not going to beat me twice.
Happel goes wide left, and Helverson to the right on third and nine. Quick comp. Give is to Gill, and he's inside the 20 to the 18-yard line. Again, June James made the stop. It'll be fourth down and bring on the kick team now for the Iowa Hawkeyes, and that means that Nickel will attempt another field goal. He kicked one to end the first half, and he will try now to give his team, the Iowa Hawkeyes, a 10-point lead.
Look at Owen Gill, 6'1", 226-pound senior. He looks like a refrigerator, a caster on wheels.
Well, we've already got one refrigerator in college football, that William Perry from Clemson. Don't they call him refrigerator?
You know, he eats everything inside the refrigerator. That's why he got the nickname.
Nickel attempts a 35-yard field goal. There's a placement of the kick by Tom. Is up. It looks to be good. It is good. So Nickel now with a 35-yard field goal and back-to-back boots at that has given the Iowa Hawkeyes a 10-point lead over Texas. There's a timeout on the field. It's 27-17. The Hawkeyes over the Longhorns. We'll be back after this. Simply another stellar performance by Iowa quarterback Chuck Long. He is 16 out of 22 for 235 yards, and we are just into the opening minutes of the third quarter. So this guy, if all things be equal in this football game, would threaten the 400-yard total passing mark today, Jack.
I think so. There's no question about it. And the interesting thing is that Hayden Fry is not pulling back on it. They're going to continue to do what they do best, that is to throw the ball, and they're getting away with it in some very inclement weather.
Tony Tillman and Kelvin Epps in the deep receiving spots. And this one is headed Tillman's way at the 3, to the 10, the 15, the 20. Trying to get outside the 25, and he's dragged down as he crosses the 25-yard line. And the stop is made by Dan Worth, number 46, a backup linebacker, who really wasn't supposed to play today. He underwent arthroscopic surgery. And there was a great question as to whether he would be back, but Worth not wanting to miss the Freedom Bowl. Freshman out of Des Moines, Iowa, has come back and made the tackle on that kickoff. So Todd Dodge on to bring Texas back into the ballgame. Terry Orr and Jerome Johnson will be his running backs. It's 27-17, and the Longhorns having the ball now for the first time in the second half. And they run from a wing formation to the left, and they put that wing in motion, the big tight end Harris. Dodge throws it to him at the 30-yard line. Boy, he is a load, isn't he, at the 32? And that'll be a quick gain of 7 or 8 yards. Mike Stoops made the stop. But William Harris, the 6'5", 234-pound sophomore from Houston, and the leading receiver on the Texas team, caught the pass.
Just a little short out route here. It's a nice pass in there by Dodge to Harris. Again, a big target, good hands. Good-looking young man, isn't he? 6'5", 234 pounds. A lot of pro teams looking at him saying, that boy is going to get bigger, too. He's going to grow, become a man. It's going to be scary.
Two more years he's got. Second down and three from the I formation. Orr is the deep back in the eye, and Dodge turns, gives it to his up back. And it's Johnson for a first down across the 35. Fumble the ball, and they rule it is Iowa's football. Johnson had the first down, and I was just about to say something nice about it. It was good to see him running the ball like that because he's been so handicapped with a broken wrist, and he pops the ball up after getting the first down, and Peterson recovers.
Watch it again here, 35, Jerome Johnson, 6'2", 219 pounds. Makes a good stutter step move to get back online, heads up in there. He gets popped right there by Station. There he is, the All-American Larry Station, the reason for the fumble.
And it dropped right down into Peterson's lap, but he's got the ball, and Iowa has the ball with a 10-point lead, and now a chance to maybe blow this game wide open. It is first down at the Texas 34-yard line for the Hawkeyes. Play action for Chucky Long. He wants it all. He fires it down the sideline. It's caught. Touchdown, Iowa. To his favorite receiver, Bill Happel, the junior out of Cedar Rapids, and he lofted the ball over the cornerback Tony Griffin's head.
Happel runs a nice out and up route there. He runs a real good move to the outside. Number 16 jumps in him. Watch this one now, coming right at you right here. Now you're going to see number 40 Bill Happel. He runs an out on Tony Griffin, turns the out into a goal. Long lays it up perfectly, lets the receiver Happel run right underneath it. He's got 16 Griffin beaten by about two steps. Great pass, great route, good catch, 7 points.
Seven catches for Happel, 97 yards and the touchdown. And Iowa now has, with this conversion, will double the score of the Texas Longhorns. There's a placement and the kick is up, and it is good. And so Iowa has struck for 10 points early in the third quarter, and I warned you about the Hawkeyes in the third quarter, Snow. They have now outscored the opposition 80-6. We'll be back. Sam Nover and Jack Snow back in Anaheim, and yes, it's a very special treat for those of us at TCS Metro Sports to be not only part of the inaugural Freedom Bowl, but pardon me, to have Captain Charles Russell and the Goodyear Blimp Columbia positioned high above this beautiful stadium, even though it's a rainy night, and giving us some of those gorgeous pictures of the stadium from high above. It is Iowa 34 and Texas 17. We have 12:05 to play here in the third quarter, so in a matter of less than 3 minutes, Jack, Iowa struck for 10 quick points and certainly strapped it on the Longhorns, and now Todd Dodge is going to have to come out of there doing something and probably throwing the ball more than they'd like to. Here's a kick by Nickel. It is long and it is deep. It's 5 yards deep, in fact, and Epps elects to down it there. Kelvin Epps, by the way, has great speed. He is the cousin of Philip Epps, the burner for the Green Bay Packers, and here again is the touchdown pass by Long.
Again, a nice pass by Chuck Long. Lays the ball out there very nice. He lets his receiver run underneath the ball. Good route by Happel. Excellent pass by Long. Leads to a touchdown.
So let's see. It's incumbent upon Texas now to get itself back in the game. You see that statistic on Chuck Long, but of course he's a man who once completed 22 in a row. So 17 of the last 19 doesn't mean a thing to him, does it?
I don't know. That's a great stat. 17 of 19. Well, that's unbelievable.
No wonder George Allen is so impressed. Here's a give to Terry Orr, and he reaches the 25-yard line in the grasp of Mike Hooks, a senior out of Omaha, Nebraska, big number 91, and that ever-present Larry Station. What an outstanding linebacker he is.
Station is excellent. We talked a lot about him at the beginning of the show, and he deserves it. There's no question about it. A great guy, intelligent kid, and an excellent football player.
Gain of 5. Texas now with a second down and 5. Certainly time is no factor in this game. We're just underway in the third quarter. They can play all night here. But they're down 17, and that's got to worry Fred Akers. Even though the team showed a spark of offense in the first half, this is not the kind of football offense and go out and score 40, 45 points. And it's apparent they're going to need 35 at least to win this game. Or again, squirming through for a couple of yards before Larry Station makes a stop. Well, that's a shot from the Goodyear Blimp, and that's our mobile unit, TCS mobile unit. That's where our director and producer are stationed, and all of our classic engineers back there giving us all the great pictures. Boy, the producer must have paid the
that's where it's dry and all the hot coffee.
That's
too,
right. You got it. Hooks is being carried off the field here and being helped to the sideline.
Well, one thing Texas doesn't want to do, there's, as you said, we've got a quarter, one full quarter, and 11 minutes and 14 seconds of the second quarter. They don't want to panic. There's plenty of time. They're going to have to mix in a little bit more medium-range passes to get that offense moving down the field. They're down 17 points, but there's plenty of time to come back, take advantage, and pull themselves within striking distance.
It is third down and 3, as you saw the graphic. Texas needing to get something sustained here, and they try the sweep now to Orr on the outside. He got a good block. 30, 35, and out of bounds near the 40. He got a great block on the far side. I'm trying to spot the man. I think it was Bill Boy Bryant. And even though he's only 5'10", 153 pounds, Fred Akers insisted his outside receivers block well to play. And that was a dandy by Bryant.
You're going to watch again here. You see 37, Terry Orr. He's trying to get outside, which he does, and you'll see 80 come inside. Boom, right there, knocks the block down. Excellent job of blocking. Good job of running.
Good shot of Terry Orr. I'm just thinking about our producer, Paul Carlson, and our director, Tom Hewitt. Not the coffee and donuts don't bother me.
It's being dry.
Yes, and warm. Yes. From the 40-yard line, Texas now trying to sustain a drive. They got receivers split left and right, and Dodge gives on the handoff to Johnson, who fumbled the last time he touched the ball. He holds on this time, covering up with both hands as Larry Station grabs him around the legs. A gain of about two. It'll be second down and eight.
A little reconstruction there. They're going to number 91, Mike Hooks, they're going to reinforce Zach and put some extra tape on it. He's telling them where it hurts a little bit. They're going to reinforce that arch area, I believe.
They've run the ball very effectively, have the Longhorns, or with 9 carries for 61 yards. Johnson, 8 carries, 56, so both of them are averaging in the neighborhood 6-7 yards a pop. They've been able to run the ball, but it's going to be difficult for them to stay on the ground to win this game. They're down by 17 at the moment. Second down and 8 for Texas, and Dodge sprinting out to his right. Throws back against the grain. He's got Morshall at the 40, and Rob Morshall to the 38-yard line. Brought down by Ken Sims, a sophomore out of East St. Louis, Illinois. Number 9, that is another Texas first down and a 20-yard completed pass.
You're going to watch Morshall, number 8. He's going to be in a slot or a wing position to your left. You're going to roll out here. Morshall's going to fake a block. Now watch him come right across the middle of your screen right there. He's running opposite of traffic. There's nobody from Iowa over there. Big play, good call. Knocked down there by number 9, Ken Sim comes in and knocks him down. Watch it again here. Now there's Dodge waiting for him to clear the linebackers. Morshall does clear the linebackers. 9, Ken Sims is in hot pursuit.
Dodge has not exactly had a bad day throwing the ball himself. He's 10 out of 14 for 98 yards, and here he comes again. Looking downfield, now tries to muscle it downfield, and it is out of bounds. The closest man to it was defensive back number 14, Keith Hunter. It was intended for Morshall, but I think it was more intended for the out of bounds.
I think so. It's a heads-up play. When you first saw the ball leave his hands, you thought, my goodness, what's he doing? He's throwing right to Iowa. But what he did is he threw the ball out of bounds. That's a heads-up play by the young quarterback.
So Iowa now setting their defensive alignment, and Fred Aker sending new people on the field with plays.
You see right there, Chuck Long is talking. Looks like Bill Snyder, the offensive coordinator. No, that's Hayden Fry. I'm sorry, Hayden.
Rob Morshall is in the backfield with Terry Orr. Now they got the two tailbacks together. They bring Johnson out, and they give it to Orr. Trying to get outside. He stiff-arms one man to the 35, and riding his back to the 33-yard line is number 29, Nate Creer. And that will be a little bit shy of the first down. It'll be a third down now for Texas to sustain the drive, and Orr is getting up very slowly on the sideline.
Looks like he heard something there. Either that or he just got the wind knocked out of him. But again, on that last play, another excellent block by Rob Morshall, number 8. Watch Orr right now. Let's see what he does with his arms right here. Watch his right hand. Let's see what happens. Boom, he pops over there. There it is right there. Boy, he gets that arm on that Iowa Hawkeye, that number 94. Knocks him to the ground. Keeps going upfield. Let's see if we can see what happens if he gets hurt here when he gets knocked out by Creer. We didn't see it.
We're back live. Third down and 6 again. Dodge faced with now enormous pressure and dragged down all the way back at the 48-yard line. And the man who got to him was Jeff Ross, a sophomore out of Indianola, Iowa, 6'4", 285 pounds, and he chased Dodge back almost to midfield.
Watch Drost right here, number 76. Now watch him take off in pursuit. Now that's 285 pounds moving. Excellent job. He also gets some help in there from 99, Richard Fryer. Another angle, look at it right here. You'll see Drost, there he comes. He's chasing him. And when Dodge sees him, he goes, oh, no, I'm getting out of here. But unfortunately, he can't outrun him.
And so for what I believe is only the second time in this game, John Telschick is back to punt. And he is just an outstanding punter. One game earlier this year, he had 6 punts and averaged 54 and a half yards a clip. This one, he hangs high. Fair catch at the 5-yard line by Bill Happel, who might have lost sight where he was. Because normally, if it's over your head at the 10, you let it go. But Happel got backed up on that one. A 43-yard punt by Telschick, but it sets Iowa up deep in their own territory. We'll be back in a moment. Well, we hope you're enjoying this football game, and whether you are or not, we remind you to join us for what we think will be another excellent matchup on the TCS Metro Sports telecast of the Aloha Bowl, December 29th, 8 o'clock Eastern Time. The Irish of Notre Dame, the Mustangs of SMU on the TCS Metro Sports Network. We invite you to check your local listings for the station in your area. 34-17 Iowa. The Hawkeyes have it first and 10 at their own 6. And Owen Gill to the 10, the 11-yard line. And he's tripped up on the far side of the field after gaining about 5 yards. And Ty Allard, who has been strangely silent tonight, made the stop, the junior out of Houston.
Good block, too, by 73, the tackle, Herb Wester. 6'7", 280-pound freshman.
It's a big football team, the Hawkeyes, and they average about 269 across that offensive line. Gaining about 5, 5.5, maybe 6 on the carry. Owen Gill, it sets up second down. And let's call it a long 4 now for Chuck Long, who may be content to stay on the ground here for a while. No! Play action pass. And it's complete. Coming back for the ball is Helverson. And he's got an Iowa first down up around the 30-yard line. Now, no sooner do you talk about remaining conservative than deep in your own end. And Chucky goes into the play action and rifles it to Helverson.
We're going to watch it again here now. Just a straight little fake here to the tailback to hold the linebackers. Scott Helverson, 87, is going to curl right in behind number 9, James Lott. There's a seam right there. The ball gets in there in good fashion. Good throw. Boy, he takes his lick, so look at him. Boy, they're beating on him like a drum. But they can't bring him down.
Steven Bragg's made the stop. 20 yards on the completed pass. And so Long now on a quick count. Gives on the delay to Owen Gill across the 35 to the 36-yard line. And a nice pickup on first down. And the quick count has been very effective for Iowa today.
It has. It helps. And what it does is it throws the defense off. If after a time you keep hearing the ball, or you know the ball snapped on 2 and 3 and sometimes 4. And what happens is mentally you set yourself to let the ball be snapped anytime after 1 or 2. And when you come out there and you go on sound, it catches you napping.
Well, at the press conference the other day, Fred Akers, the head coach of Texas, said that Chuck Long would be the best quarterback Texas faced all year. I don't think he had any idea what he was getting into when he thought he was good going in. But Long has just had an incredible day. Throws this one out, and it's caught up around the 50-yard line. Eric Jeffries has Scott Helverson in his grasp. But Long just puts it where only the receiver can catch the ball. He is having an uncanny night in the most adverse of conditions, a wet field and continuing rain.
You're going to see Howson right down at the bottom of the little left of your screen. Now watch him run an out pattern. Long just flicks that ball out there real quick. What's a great shot there from the blimp.
Long is now 19 of 25 for 303 yards. You bet 400 yards is in jeopardy. He may put a number up there that Freedom Bowl participants will be shooting at for a lot of years to come. Of course, everything they do tonight is a record because it's the inaugural bowl game. Long wants it all. Downfield, and it's caught. Touchdown, Iowa. Unbelievable. Chuck Long to Robert Smith, and here it is again, Jack Snow.
Watch him lay it out right there. He's going to beat number 9, James Lott. Looks like Lott may slip right here. He does. If he doesn't go down, he bats the ball down. But great concentration there by number 2, Robert Smith. Fourth touchdown pass of the night for Chuck Long.
And Tom Nichol is on to attempt the extra point. Well, there are your stats. You don't have to be a mathematical genius to figure out that's a career for some people.
You may get to 400 before this quarter's over. You know that, Sam?
Oh, that is unbelievable. And what a terrific young kid he is, too. We visited him with him only briefly the other day before practice, but he's a great young man, and he's certainly his fruits of labor during the course of the season are being tremendously rewarded. The extra point is up and good. And so Iowa now threatening to blow Texas right out of the Big A at Anaheim.
We're going to see it again here. Now here's Chuck Long. He's dropping back, straight drop back, little play action fake to his tailback. Now watch him air that ball out. He does throw the ball short. There's no question of it. Number 9, Lott, almost makes the interception there, but number 2, Robert Smith from Iowa, keeps his eyes on the ball. But Long, you're going to see something here. You watch Robert Smith. Watch his head bop around once he crosses the end zone. He's looking for a flag. He doesn't want anybody to accuse him of offensive pass interference. Watch him right here now. All of a sudden, Lott goes down. Now watch him look around. He's right there. See, no flag. Make sure there's no flag. I didn't push him. And you know what? He had his hand on his behind. Great job, Robert Smith.
Only another receiver would know that trick.
Absolutely. Great job, number 2.
7:09 to play third quarter. It's 41-17, Iowa over Texas. And we have plenty of time left, obviously. Tillman and Epps in the deep receiving spots awaiting this kick from Tom Nichol. So the Hawkeyes, who won a football game at Hawaii, so they at least won their last outing and were able to build off that coming into the Freedom Bowl. On the other hand, Texas was not. They lost their last two games to Baylor and Texas A&M. And they went out of the regular season with their tails between their legs, and Fred Akers had hoped that the weeks between that game and this one would remove the stigma of those losses, but apparently it lingers a little bit, although in self-defense of the Texas football team, they just were decimated by graduation. And I think their start had to be somewhat deceiving. It was not commensurate with the kind of talent they really had. They got off to a 6-0-1 start and were ranked number one in the nation. And they had only really... Well, here comes a return now, and back to the 21-yard line is Tony Tillman. He brings it up to the 23, maybe, and stopped there by Ken Sims. But they lost 22 players to graduation, or 22 players who were signed last year by professional football teams.
95 yards in almost 2 minutes. Excellent drive. Five plays, long to Smith, 49-yard touchdown. There he is, number two. Turn around, Robert, let the camera see you.
See if we still got Todd Dodge in there at quarterback. We do indeed. Number 13 is still quarterbacking the Longhorns from the 22-yard line. And he's got that big center, Gene Chilton, out in front of him, 6'3", 295. And he throws it on the run, and it's incomplete. Intended on the near side here for Rob Morshall. But Dodge could be excused on that throw because he had people chasing him all over back there.
He got pressure again from number 50, Hap Peterson, who pushed him out of the pocket. He saw Hap about 10 minutes ago. Didn't like what he saw. There's Pryor, number 99, also in there, the outside linebacker.
It's going to get fun for that defensive front five now for Iowa, because they can almost pin their ears back and come on every down. I mean, they know that Texas has got to put the ball in the air. Although you talked about Dodge's discipline when they were down 14 points and didn't have to panic, I would imagine that, you know, they can score three times here. Except three won't get them back in the game, unfortunately. They need more than three. Dodge throws it downfield, and it is incomplete. Intended at the 40-yard line for Bill Boyd Bryan, and broken up there by number 38, I believe it was. Kevin Spitzig, the linebacker, who came all the way back to defend against the wide receiver.
It was a nice play, too. It was a good pass. Dodged through a nice tight spiral. It was a good route. Threw it to Bill Boyd Bryan, number 80, but Creer, number 29, came in and knocked the
ball
down.
I'm sorry, I thought it was Spitzig, but it was Creer indeed. So it's third down now for Texas, and they have some problems deep in their own end, trying to get something sustained. Harris, the tight end, in motion. And again, pressure and down. Dodge goes back at the 13. And that time, Hap Peterson was having himself quite a ball game as a backup defensive nose tackle, and replacing the injured Paul Hufford, puts him down on his back.
You're going to watch right there, number 50. He just gets around the center, 74, Gene Tilton, too quick. Tilton is not fast enough to stop Hap Peterson. He's into that backfield in his second or third step. The offensive center for the Texas can't contain him. Watch it right there. Boom, he's right by him. Puts the pressure, nails Dodge, down he goes.
So on fourth down, John Telschick is back at his own goal line. And he'll have a chance to show the strength of his leg here. And he rifles one up to the 50. It takes a bounce and is caught by a Texas man at about the 46-yard line. And so the Iowa Hawkeyes get it back. Only a 39-yard punt by Telschick, but no return. And the ball was caught by Tex Mercer, a defensive back. And let's see where they spotted, about the 47-yard line, Jack. So now, when you most expect Iowa to probably work on the clock, we'll see what happens.
Well, I think two things they want to do. They want to keep their momentum going, but they don't want to put the ball up needlessly. You can keep it on the ground, eat the clock up, but the only problem there is you're not doing what you do best, and that's to throw the ball.
6:08 to play third quarter. And the Hawkeyes have really come out here and blitzed the Longhorns in the third quarter. They have scored 17 unanswered points. And as I said, going out at halftime, this is a team that outscored the opposition 70-13 in the third quarter, and they break loose again on another big run, and a flag goes down. Carrying the ball is Owen Gill to about the 37-yard line, dragged down by June James. Well, apparently there is no flag. It'll be a first down, though, as Owen Gill reaches the Texas 37-yard line.
Watch Gill again here, number 33. Nice cut back in, uses his blockers very well, cut right in behind 35, Fred Bush. Here comes the Texas Longhorns swarming in. Owen's running the ball very well, and I'm considering, again, as we mentioned earlier, he's got a neck injury, he's got a kidney injury, he's got a rib injury, he's doing a great job.
16 yards on the carry and long to the airwaves again, and this one is knocked down. Somebody got up in his face, leaped high, and knocked it down. It may have been Tony DeGrate. Jim Moore, number 75, was also there, but somebody slapped it down. So it's an incompleted pass, and it stops the clock. Second down and 10 now, Iowa. And Long's looking for maybe 500 before the night's over.
How rapidly you advance in 2 minutes.
All right, 400 would have been enough.
Yes, yes.
The ball is on the 37-yard line of Texas. Iowa in possession. And the Longhorns with the nickel back, using the five defensive backs. They could use seven back there. It might not help tonight, the way Long's throwing the ball. Here he is again, dancing around. Now he's going to run with the ball. 30-25. And slides to the 20 and gets the first down. He's nobody's fool, is he? He may be 6'4", 212, but he didn't want to run into anybody in that secondary.
Interesting. You know, we're into the third quarter, and there's 5 minutes to go. If you've noticed, most everything that Iowa has done passing-wise, you watch it right here. There he goes, up the field. Gets a good block there from number 34, just knocks somebody down, Jonathan Hayes, a tight end. What Iowa has done passing-wise, they've kept everything out of the middle of the field. Everything they've run has been short outs, medium outs, goes on the outside and coming back inside.
18 yards on the carry. It is first down now for Iowa, and they are just inside the Texas 20-yard line. And here's Long again. Now looking back against the grain, delivers a ball in the end zone, and Smith tried to come back for it, and there's the flag. Yep. Good call.
You bet. Real good call. Eric Jeffries, number one, he's upset, but there's no question he held him. Smart move, though, because it's only going to be a penalty, I believe. They're not going to give him the ball on the 2-yard line.
So it'll be a first down and goal to go now for Iowa as the flag continues to lay in the end zone. And the officials talking it over, but it's quite obvious what happened. Smith tried to get back to the ball.
Let's watch it again here. Now the receiver's trying to run a corner route. He comes inside in good fashion, tries to get back outside. I think that's Robert Smith, number two. Right there you can see the pull down by the Texas defender. We're going to see it from another angle. You be the judge now. Watch the ball. Here it's in the air. See if the receiver is knocked down by the defender, if there's any interference whatsoever. No question of it. Yeah, there's too much contact to let that go.
So let's see where they spot the ball. They're still talking about it. And it's at about the 4-yard line. Now, why it's there, I'll never know.
It'll be a 10-yard penalty, I think. No longer will they spot the ball.
No, it's interference is supposed to be 15, but that would be half the distance from the 20. It would be the 10. Why is it at the 4?
Even number.
You can't walk off 15 inside the 20 unless that's part of that rule. 15 yards anywhere that you can get 15 yards.
Yeah, I think it maybe where was the ball on the 20-yard line, so they give him 15 to take it down to the 4.5.
So they spot the ball at the 4-yard line. Nonetheless, Iowa has the ball with a first down and goal to go, looking for more, and they already lead here 41-17. Here's Long back to pass, looking for his fifth touchdown pass, and it's there to Helverson. Touchdown, Iowa. What a night for Chuck Long and the Iowa Hawkeyes. 4 yards to his receiver, Scott Helverson. And it's now 47-17.
Watch right here. Another great pass. Look at the location of the ball. Right inside the marker right there. He beats Lott. He's going to beat Lott number 9. Lott isn't that far away. But remember, now look at the location of the football, where he places it. Just inside the end zone, right there next to the pylons. Nice shot by Chuck Long.
And so Tom Nichol will attempt the extra point. The placement. Spotted by Long. It's up and it is good. And so Iowa has simply just blown Texas out here in the third quarter. It is hard to believe they have scored 24 unanswered points in this quarter alone. We had what we thought was the most competitive football game at halftime. 24-17, but it's taken them about 10 minutes here in the third quarter to put 3 touchdowns in the end zone at a field goal and just simply blow the Longhorns out of Anaheim.
Well, this kid right here is looking at number 16, Chuck Long. He's picking that secondary of Texas apart. Again, as it, you know, what's happening is he's staying away from Jerry Gray, number 2. Everything he's doing is going outside. You can look at the great, that's Jerry the Great right there, the Lombardi Award winner, number 99. He's really upset. He didn't think he's contributing enough to the Texas defense, but he's got to realize they're going to have 2 and 3 guys on him all night long. It's been successful, and that's what Iowa's going to continue to do. We're going to double and triple block him.
So Tony Tillman and Kelvin Epps are back to return yet another Tom Nichol kickoff. 48-17 Iowa. And if you just joined us, the score certainly grew by leaps and bounds here in the third quarter. It certainly is not an indication of what happened in the first half when Texas spotted Iowa an early 14-0 lead, came back to trail by only 7 at the half, 24-17. And we thought we'd move into a pretty good second half of play, but it has been all Iowa and Chuck Long, who may set some passing marks here that may take a long time to be equal in the first ever Freedom Bowl. And hopefully there'll be a second and a third and a tenth, because we've had a great week out here, Jack.
There'll be another game. This is a great game. It's a great game for two good schools.
Epps bobbles the ball in the end zone. It'll come out to the 20-yard line. So again, time is still not a factor. It's just whether or not Texas can do it. And they certainly have their work cut out for them, trailing here by 31 points. 4:50 to go in the third quarter. The Iowa team record, Jack was just indicating to me, for touchdown passes in a game was way back in 1963 by Fred Riddle against Indiana, and Long has tied that today. Bill Hattie from the Sports Information Office of Iowa has come up to supply us with that information. We appreciate it. So Long, I presume, will be going to the air again looking for a record, Phil. Here's a pitch downfield. The dodge, and it may go all the way. He throws it down, and it's caught at the 40-yard line. Brent Duhon still on his feet, out of bounds at the 35. So the old high school tandem from Port Arthur, Texas, hooks up for a big gainer, 45 yards from Dodge to Duhon.
You're going to see Duhon coming across from right to left across the middle of your screen right here. Great passing there by Dodge. Excellent catch by Brent Duhon, number 7. The knock on him is his lack of speed, but I'll tell you what, he picks up a lot of yardage here. Look at him trying to look for blockers. That's an intelligent receiver. Stays on his feet, gets everything he can. Finally run out of bounds there. Good job by Brent Duhon, number 7.
And just his first reception of the night. 5'11", 168, and as I said, a high school a partner with Todd Dodge. They broke all sorts of Texas high school records. Dodge, in fact, first high schooler in Texas to throw for over 3,000 yards. Here's another one downfield. That was intended for Bill Boy Bryant and was badly overthrown, so it stops the clock. Second down, and Dodge re-huddles now as Texas tries to strike very quickly here and try to get back in the football game. They trail 48-17.
They're not going to pass consistently to get back in this ballgame. They're going to have to mix up, get run outside. They're going to have to get their big tailbacks, 37, Terry Orr, maybe Rob Morshall, and bounce them outside for some gainers, because I don't think they can get back in the game by strictly throwing the football.
Well, you'd have to go back, I think, in the record books a little bit to see the last team that scored 48 points on a Texas team, or maybe you wouldn't. It seemed it would be sometime. Certainly nobody has done that this year. The most scored against them this year was the 37 by A&M in their last game. And there's a fumble, and Iowa, I believe, has the football. They do indeed. Jeff Drost recovered the fumble of Terry Orr, and so a Texas scoring opportunity has vanished, and the Hawkeyes have the ball again. And what more misfortune can befall the Texas Longhorns tonight?
Right there, Orr has the ball in good fashion, but gets it slopped away from him real quickly, real slick by an Iowa defender, and 76 comes in, falls on a Jeff Drost. Terrible turnover for Texas at this stage of the game.
And so here comes Chucky Long and company, if he is still in there, and he is indeed. We might get to see Mark Vlasic, the backup quarterback in this game, but for now it's Long and the records that he is putting up on the board. Here he is again throwing on first down, and this one is juggled at the 40 and caught. Rick Bayless is the man who made the catch, and June James puts him down. A short gain there by Chucky Long. I'm wondering if Akers may record this in the back of his mind, that Hayden Fry, with a 31-point lead late in the third quarter, was still throwing the football at him, should these teams ever meet again, and they have never met before, incidentally.
They'll meet again sometime down the road, but you know, Hayden Fry and Akers have met in the past. Hayden's an old West Texas quarterback. He's taking his lumps against some of these coaches, believe me.
Well, I'll tell you something after this play, too, that I'm sure you're aware of, Jack, that maybe our viewing audience isn't. Here's Bayless on a handoff to about the 43-yard line. And this may be a reason why Hayden Fry is trying to get all out of this game that he can. He has faced Texas teams 13 times before as a coach, most of them at SMU, and he is 2-11 going into the game. So he has not tasted victory very often, and he's going to make this one about as sweet as he can.
He wants to get a good cushion. He realizes the third quarter is his power quarter, and he's going to take every advantage of it.
And when you think of the fact that now, through this football game and almost through this entire quarter, that Iowa has outscored the opposition 94-13 in the third quarter, you have to attribute a great deal of that to their coaching staff for having made the halftime adjustments.
Absolutely. Bill Snyder, their offensive coordinator, has done an excellent job with the Iowa offense the last several years.
Here's a give to Eddie Polite, number 26, carrying for the first time in the game. And he nudges his way across the 45-yard line. So it'll be third down for Iowa now, the better part of 5 yards as time is expiring here in the third quarter. Nope, I guess he got the first down. I beg your pardon. I thought he had a little bit more to go, but he got the first down as he went across the 45-yard line. So they moved the sticks, and the clock begins again with 2.5 minutes to play in the third quarter. And this third quarter has lasted an eternity for Texas. Long, back to pass. Throws one out in the right flat, and this one is caught. At the 45, racing down the near far sideline with the football is Robert Smith, number two, and he's chased out of bounds by Jerry Gray. This is unbelievable. It's almost like nobody's back there.
Well, they're doing all that play action to get the receivers isolated on the defensive backs, and that's the second time in the last 4 minutes. You watch it right there. Number two is Robert Smith. He's going to isolate on number nine Lott. He gets by Lott, turns the afterburners on. There he is, number two. Jerry Gray comes over and saves the day again for Texas.
23 yards on the completed pass from Long to Robert Smith, and Chuck Long is perilously close to 400 yards throwing the football, and he's still got a quarter to go. 23-yard line of Texas. Long to throw on almost every down. An out pattern caught by Happel, his 8th catch of the night at the 15-yard line. And that will be close to another Iowa first down. John Hagee, number 17, had the coverage. But when he throws a quick out pattern like that, there's almost nothing you can do to defend against him.
You're looking to one of the better receivers, number 40, Happel. Watch him. Watch Long. He just lets the ball go right down. Now watch Happel's feet. Right there. He knows right where he is. He drags that right foot inbounds. Great camera shot. Good job by Bill Happel.
Number 29, Rowan, comes into the ball game now for the Iowa Hawkeyes. And Flag comes in at tight end. It is second down and short yardage. And the give on a dive play. Nope. Play action pass and a touchdown. He fooled me. I thought he had given to the running back. And he throws for the touchdown to Jonathan Hayes. And a school record 6 touchdown passes in one game by Chuck Long, and Hayden Fry loves it. And Freddie Akers has to admire it.
I'll tell you one thing, Sam. You better get out your flip card, because we're going to see names of guys we don't know exist out there, believe me, in this fourth quarter. Let's watch it again right here. Great job of hiding the ball there by Long. There's 34, Jonathan Hayes, all alone. Again, number two, Jerry Gray, is a little late getting there. I'll tell you what, the defensive backs, you can't see him tonight on the majority of these pass plays for touchdown because of the great ball handling by Chuck Long.
So Nickel will attempt the extra point now. And there's a placement. The kick is up, and it is good. Kind of slipped as he was kicking the ball. But the extra point is good. It's now a 55-17 game, and there are the stats right up to the moment. Long has only missed on 7 throws tonight, over 400 yards, a school record 6 touchdown passes, and if that won't impress the pro scouts, nothing will.
Watch it again right here. Boy, does he cover that ball up very nice. Now he's looking for number 34, Hayes, all the way. As soon as he sees he's open, he gets rid of that ball in a hurry. Gray just can't get there in time. Sometimes you think Texas may ask too much of Jerry Gray to patrol that whole center field back there by himself.
I would think they do, and obviously the secondary needs some work, but they are a very inexperienced core. Now Long, with a big smile on his face, he's got to be loving this.
I just want to let the fans know that number two, Jerry Gray, that was not his man, because he's playing free safety. Now the strong safety is supposed to pick up the tight end, 34, Jonathan Hayes. So Gray's getting over there late, but he's still getting over there, but that is not his job.
And again, Tillman and Epps in the deep receiving spot. Nickel's going to have a sore leg by the time the night's over. He's kicked a couple of field goals, and it seems like he's kicked off 100 times already in the game. It's unbelievable what's happened to this football game. It may be repetitious to say it, but it looked competitive. And Texas had come back in the second quarter, and you just had to assume that a team of this quality, even though they ended the year on the note they did, would gut it up in the second half, come out here, and certainly play respectably. But I don't think anybody in their wildest dreams believed that Iowa would outscore them 31-0 in the third quarter and have no turnovers, Jeff.
Unbelievable.
This has not been a turnover play football game, considering the field conditions.
Absolutely.
Tillman to the 15. 20. Took it outside to the 27, and that's where Texas will begin. With, I presume, Todd Dodge at quarterback, or let's see whether Freddie Akers goes to somebody else. The only clean jersey on the field is he's got Rob Morshall out there and Bobby Duhon.
There again, it's scoring to 65 yards, again, under 2 minutes. 6 plays, 3 passes, 3 rushes. Long to Hayes, 15-yard touchdown pass.
We're looking for the last time that anybody scored this number of points at all on a Texas team. And you got to go back a few years. We're at 55 now, so that would erase the 52 scored against him at 73. William Harris with a catch up around the 32-yard line.
That's a great catch. That's a basketball catch. He one-handed that ball, got control, and brought it in. We're going to see it right here. What Dodge dropped back. Now watch. This is a good pass. He lays it in there right in the pocket. Look at the hand right there. Gets that right hand up in the air. Of course, he's a big guy. He pulls it down, controls it. Great catch by William Harris, the youngster.
And there's Larry Station right there. He forced Harris to make the great behind-the-back grab. And it was a great catch by Harris from the 37-yard line. So here's Todd Dodge. He hasn't quit trying to get something going again for his club. Down 55-17. Now he's being chased back there. Gets out of one man's grasp and throws it away into the sideline, into the Iowa bench. And we're waiting for a flag, but none appears. Yes, it does. It's late. But it is intentional grounding, and it was rather apparent that that would be the call. It took the official a long time.
That's a good call. There's no question. I think the official, what he tried to do is make sure there was no receivers in the area. It's a good call. It's downing the ball. They'll lose a penalty plus the loss of down.
Iowa's warming up their backup quarterback, Mark Vlasic, the sophomore, out of Monaca, Pennsylvania. Well, you ready for this, Jack Snow? We go back to 1904 to find a team that scored this many points against Texas. Would you care to guess who it was?
It was,
don't look.
Central Wesleyan.
That's not a bad guess. No, it was the University of Chicago, which stopped playing football about
1905.
Yeah, 1904, they beat Texas 68-0. Well, it's not funny to Fred Akers, I'm sure, and maybe we're making light of it, but it's nobody in their wildest dreams. This game was a pick'em football game, and Iowa now leads at 55-17. After the intentional grounding call, Dodge, in almost to his end zone, throws it, and almost another great one-handed catch by the tight end William Harris, who is going to be some dandy football player if he's not already. Let's pause 5 seconds for station identification.
KCRG TV 9, Cedar Rapids, Waterloo, Iowa.
1:34 to go in the third quarter. Sam Nover and Jack Snow back at the Big A in Anaheim, California. The stadium that seats 71,000, the home for the LA Rams and the California Angels. And we haven't got a crowd count tonight. We know they sold 30,000 tickets or thereabouts. There can't be more than 15 in the building because it has been a rainy, rather dreary night, and a particularly dreary night for Texas. Dodge on a quarterback draw to the 22-yard line, and so Texas now will have to kick the ball away. The inaugural Freedom Bowl, and as we have said many times during the course of this night, it has been an absolutely beautiful week out here in Southern California. It's just a darn shame that Tom Starr and his entire staff on the Freedom Bowl committee weren't able to have a nice evening with which to play football and maybe get another 5 or 10 at the gate and have a respectable crowd of 40,000 to start this bowl off. Telchik, having trouble with a wet ground, gets a Texas bounce inside the 40 to the 35, and it rolls dead at about the 33-yard line, and that's where Iowa will go to work, and they go to work with a second-string quarterback, I do believe, as Mark Vlasic will come on. Chuck Long has done all that could be asked of him. 25 of 32, 414 yards, and a school record 6 touchdowns. I don't know how you could ever duplicate it, and I don't know why in the world you'd ever ask another man to come on again. But is he out there? He is still on the field. Aiden Fry's got to be crazy. He's still out there. And the rain now getting a bit heavier. Long is going to throw on first down. And he's finally chased out of bounds and stops the clock up around the 37-yard line. What's going on here, Snow? Don't you think it's time to pull him out?
I think what happened is Hayden heard you talk about him hitting the 500-yard mark, and that's exactly what he's trying to do.
Oh, my goodness. He needs 44 yards to get to 500. Unofficially, so let's see. Let's see whether or not that's what Fry has on his mind. I think Hayden Fry would feel a little silly if Long were to sustain an injury now that that would do anything to hinder certainly his senior year if he elects to come back or his pro career.
He may be just letting him finish out this third quarter.
Long dumps off in the right flat. It's caught by Eddie Polite, and he's dragged down at the 39-yard line. He needs only 4 yards, I guess, to break the school record. Is that it, Charlie? 4 yards to break the Iowa school record, so that's really what we're talking about. He's more than 44 away from 500. But he needs 4 yards to break the record. Tony Edwards made the good tackle on Eddie Polite. And we are almost at the end of this third quarter, mercifully for the Texas Longhorns. 10-9-8, they won't get another playoff. They will change sides and perhaps change quarterbacks, but for Texas, unfortunately, they can't change the score. That is the end of the third quarter in the first Freedom Bowl from Anaheim, California. It was 24-17 Iowa at the half. It is now the Hawkeyes 55 and the Longhorns 17. We'll be back. With the Goodyear blimp Columbia hovering above the Big A in Anaheim, this is Sam Noper along with Jack Snow. Fourth quarter action about to begin. The Iowa Hawkeyes with that monstrous 55-17 lead. And Chuck Long is still in at quarterback, looking for school records, throws one down the sideline. It's caught by Robert Smith at the 30-yard line. That will break or will tie the record for most completions in a season by an Iowa Hawkeye. And that will break the total yardage mark in one game as he goes well over 450 yards. The previous mark of 421. June James had the coverage, and there it is, Jack.
Robert Smith makes a great catch. June James is right there, number 62, but he never turns around to find the ball. He's looking at the receiver all the way. Smith's concentration picks it up. There he is. What a fantastic night, Chuck Long. Look at those. 27 completions, 34 attempts, 447 yards, and six touchdowns. Unbelievable.
And as our spotter Chuck Panama has pointed out repeatedly, in a steady downpour.
Absolutely. Not real good weather. He's the Dan Marino of college football.
And here's the pass now on first down by the backup, Mark Vlasic. And to prove that he is not going to be outdone by his predecessor, he completes the pass to J.C. Lovejordan. And they'll get the ball to the 23-yard line. And as you just said, Jack, we're going to see players playing this game that we didn't have on our seven deep chart, I can tell you that.
Look at that, 241 yards passing, 301 total yards. Third quarter offense, unbelievable. 31 points. Woo-hoo.
You may never see another quarter like that again anywhere. Over 300 yards in one quarter total offense by one team. That's not combined yardage. Here's Vlasic rolling to the left. Chase is on, and he's going to be collared over on the 25-yard line, and some Texas lads making him pay for it, or at least making him pay for what Long did, Jack.
Well, that's exactly what's going to happen. That Texas defense is going to make, if you look at him, they're going to make him pay for what 16 did. When you do that again, young man, Vlasic, get out of bounds.
Ty Allert was the first one to make contact. So now Iowa faced with a third down and five to go at the 25-yard line of the Texas Longhorns, leading here 55-17. And yes, if you're wondering what the Iowa school record is for most points in a game, it is 70, scored against Utah State back in 1957. So they certainly are within range of that. They've scored 55 in this ball game. They can tie it, but no, they can't. They need three scores. Flag is down as they send Eddie Polite into the line of scrimmage for a couple of yards. He, I believe, is shy of the first down, but a penalty marker is down and stops the clock. And while it does, both Jack and I want to certainly, even prematurely in this broadcast, thank our great support crew here. Our spotters, Jim Pels and Chuck Panama. Our statistician, Charlie Fisher, who flew all the way from Pennsylvania, Altoona, to be with us. And John Grohall, who also came out of Altoona, Pennsylvania. And these guys, including you, Snow, on your way to the sunny weather and the Aloha Bowl in Honolulu. And I'm a little envious, I don't mind telling you.
Sam, you do me a favor, call me Jack. Make me feel better.
Well, I used to call Trumpy all the time. You big football players, I thought you liked to be called by your last name.
Yeah, but Trumpy doesn't look good in a coat and tie, though.
That's right. He sure doesn't. From the 20-yard line, the first down, the penalty against Texas, Jack, and his first down. Anybody bigger than me, I'll just call you Mr. Snow. Would that be all right?
No, just call me
okay.
JT's fine.
From the blind side, Vlasic is ripped down to the 30-yard line.
Stephen Bryce came in there and nailed him on that one, number six. They had the blitz on, the safety blitz.
Well, they're going to make the second teamers pay, I think, and Bragg's really put a lick on Vlasic. Vlasic apparently has injured himself here, and we're going to get Chuck Long back in there because they haven't got another quarterback. They've got to bring Long back in. They've only got two quarterbacks. Isn't that ironic? You'd think you put the kid away for the night, and they've only got two quarterbacks, and Vlasic gets hurt on, what, his fourth or fifth play, and they only carry two quarterbacks on this team. It's apparently his wrist, and Long's got to come right back in there again. And he's going to do what he does best again. He throws this one downfield, and it's incomplete, intended around the goal line for Quinn Early, number one, the receiver, and it stops the clock. They are taking Mark Vlasic to the dressing room, and he has obviously suffered a wrist injury. And they're moving him along pretty good there, Jack.
When he got hit by Bragg's number six, I think what happened is he might have had his wrist hit with the helmet. They're going to go check him for a broken wrist, see exactly what happened. A wrist or a couple of fingers or whatever, because he took a direct shot on that hand.
So Iowa now has third down and 17. The ball is back at the Texas 27-yard line. And Chuck Long is right back in the lineup again. So don't go anywhere. You may see a 500-yard passing performance tonight. Or who knows, maybe 600 yards. Sky is the limit. Long rolling out to the right, delivers the ball on the money to the 20. And that will be shy of the first down. Love Jordan made the catch, the senior out of Robbins, Illinois. And it'll be fourth down. John Hagee with the coverage. And let's see whether or not Hayden Fry elects to go for a field goal. I do believe he's bringing Tom Nichol on the field. So leading 55-17, Nichol will attempt an extra point here.
Nice pass right there. Nice catch by Love Jordan, who runs about an 8-9 yard out, comes out, makes a good catch, loses the ball there at the end, but he's already down.
How do you feel about this, Jack, going for a field goal under these circumstances? I'm really serious about it.
Well, you got to do something. You don't want to put the ball in the air, and you don't want to run the ball, because then your kids know that you're not trying. You got to try every time you get the ball.
So Nichols, and they try the fake, and it doesn't work. Kevin Harmon, the holder, tried to fake and move out with the football, and he was tripped up behind the line of scrimmage. And so we've seen a little bit of everything here in this football game tonight. There's a timeout on the field. It's 55-17 Iowa. Back in Anaheim, the inaugural Freedom Bowl, and Iowa certainly has put a number on the board that teams will look at for a lot of years to come. It is first down, and Todd Dodge looks right and then throws back to his left. He's got a man streaking down the sideline, and it's incomplete on the near side right in front of the Iowa bench. It was intended for Nelson out of the backfield, number 20, Kevin Nelson it is, number 32, and the pass was just a little bit tall for him and goes incomplete.
Look at Dodge. Boy, he's had a hard day's work, hasn't he? Hard evening's work.
Jack, what do you feel about Chuck Long turning pro at the end of this year? And as we mentioned, he has another year of eligibility if he wants it. You think he ought to go out on this performance, or an all-star performance if he's going to play in the East-West game or something like that? We can talk about it after this play. Todd Dodge dumps it off, caught by Johnson behind the line of scrimmage, breaks a tackle, and a good effort by Johnson across the 35 to the 37-yard line.
It's hard to say, you know. I'm an advocate of college football because it's such a lot of fun, and there's so many things that go along with college football. The crowds, the noise, the records, the homecomings, the stadiums. It's just fantastic. You go to the pro game, and it's a different type of game. Now you're paying for or playing for money, and it's totally, the approach is totally different. Not that he won't make the money. On the other hand, you got to say, well, if USFL is not in existence in 2 years, how does that diminish his bargaining
right.
power? Maybe a valid point.
That's a consideration. Third down and seven, and Dodge again. Fires one. Good one-handed catch by Morshall. Fighting for the first down. He didn't make it. He's about a yard shy. But an excellent one-handed catch by Rob Morshall as he had to spin around. George Davis made the tackle secure at the 39. It'll be fourth down and one for Texas. And one guess as to what Fred Akers will do here. You won't see Telchek the rest of the night, I don't believe.
I don't think so. I also don't think we're going to see Chuck Long either.
Well, that's exactly what Chuck Long has completed in one performance here tonight in a little over three quarters. School records, all of them. Most completions, most yards passing, most touchdown passes.
He's got his Walkman on. That's why he's smiling. So he's got this rock and roll radio.
Listen to another radio station, huh? Fourth down and the pitch. A flag goes down, and it may be delay a game. As they tried to pitch it out to the running back, Michael Brown, number 27. And the play was stopped almost as it began. Illegal procedure here, I think, against Texas.
You know, Sam, we talked about Mark Vlasic having to leave the game with an injured wrist and then Chuck Long coming back in. I wouldn't be surprised if we saw his number seven, Kevin Harmon, come in and play quarterback for Iowa.
He is their backup third-string quarterback in the case of an emergency, but you notice that the minute their second teamer went down, they went right back to Long again.
Well, they want to give Harmon, I think, a little chance to warm up a little bit because he probably went into shock, Harmon did, when, oh, my goodness, I'm next.
Yeah, you're right. Well, here's Telchek now on fourth down and six, so they are going to punt again. Goes to show you how much I know about it. Punting barefoot. Telchek. Line drive. Bounces at the 30. Inside the 30 to the 25. It'll rolled dead somewhere near the 15-yard line. He'll get a great bounce out of it. This has not been a vintage performance by John Telchik in the football game, but he's gotten some mileage out of it. 48 yards, and the ball rolls dead. So there's a timeout on the field, 9.5 minutes to play in this one, and Iowa will win the inaugural Freedom Bowl game. I think we can safely say that. We'll be back. Sam Noper and Jack Snow back at the Big A in Anaheim. We've done everything within our power here to get Chuck Long out of the game, but he's still in there. And again, you see from high above that excellent shot at the Goodyear Blimp Columbia. Captain Charles Russell at the controls, as he has been all night, and we appreciate the beautiful view. Here's Long throwing again on first down and completing the pass on the far sideline at the 22-yard line to Quinn Early, number one. So everybody's getting into the act. Eric Jennings, or Jeffries rather, made the stop, but Long, believe it or not, is still in the football game, and he's still throwing the ball.
Yeah, I find that just a little bit hard to believe now. There's, 9 minutes to go in the ball game, and you got your number one quarterback still in the game, and you know, you're blowing the other team out, and you don't want to put the ball in the air. You want to get him out, let some other kids have a chance to play, and keep the ball on the ground, run the clock out.
Well, as I indicated, Kevin Harmon is only a third-string quarterback in the case of an emergency, and I guess Hayden Fry doesn't consider this an emergency. It is second down and about six or about four for Iowa at the 21.5-yard line, and this is a delay, and the give to number seven Harmon, who's in the ball game but not as a quarterback, and it's like a Chinese fire drill out there as they're dancing all over the place. I don't think Harmon knew where he was supposed to be. Long is so unaccustomed to handing the ball off, he didn't know where to put it.
He found a ball in front of him. He said, "What do I do with it?"
They did not make the first down. It'll be third down, and the best thing to happen about this series is that Iowa's staying on the ground here, at least in this play, and the clock continues to run with 8.5 minutes to play. Boy, if I were sitting on that other sideline, wet, cold, losing 55-17, I don't think I'd ever forgive Hayden Fry. Third down and three.
They may not.
What do you think Long's going to do? Throws it again, and this one is incomplete into the Iowa bench. I think he was looking for his receiver to turn an out pattern, and he did a stop right at the 35-yard line. Tony Griffin with the coverage there for Texas, so it's fourth down. And Iowa will punt the ball for one of the infrequent times in this game tonight.
How many times have
Gary
they punted?
Costrevalla, excuse me.
Once or twice?
I think Costrevalla punted a couple of times early on. Two punts we've got on the graphic there.
First so two series, right.
That was about it. And he hasn't had to come on the field again tonight. And he hangs a beautiful one up. Driving kick drives Morshall back to the 30-yard line. To the 35, and that's about all Rob's going to get out of it. 46 yards on the punt by Castrovalla. So there's a timeout on the field. 8:05 to play in the game. Score hasn't changed. Neither has the weather. It's 55-17 Iowa. Well, you can add another record, another school record for Chuck Long. Total yardage in one game by one man, 484 yards. Here is a pass over the middle, completed by Texas to the 40, the 45-yard line. Rob Morshall with the completed pass. And Todd Dodge continuing to throw the football. And they still got most of their starters in there on offense, Jeff.
Well, they want to get respectable now. If they're going to try and put another touchdown for sure, maybe two more on the board, at least get out of here with some respectability.
Orr is in the backfield with Morshall. It is first down the Longhorns at their own 45-yard line. And Dodge now dropping back. Throws one over the middle. Orr tried to one-hand the ball at the 48, and he couldn't hold on. And it'll stop the clock. The incompleted pass stops the clock. Hayden Fry had mentioned to us that one of the things he wanted Iowa to do was kind of buckle down early in the week here and not play as much, and then let the kids stay out here for a couple of days after the game to enjoy themselves. And apparently that's paid off fairly well for him, because the team has worked hard. And so they'll now have a couple of days to enjoy it even more, Jack. Second down, Texas and Dodge back to pass again. Same play to Orr. Has it knocked loose at the 50-yard line, and they're going to call it an incompleted pass. All three officials right there signal simultaneously that the pass was not in the possession of Orr. George Davis really hammered the young man and knocked the ball free.
Watch Dodge right here now. He gets the ball in there. Is there any control? Doesn't look like he has control long enough. We can't see because his back was turned to us. But he's got to have absolute control. Plus, there's a difference of, 37 or 41 points, too.
So from the 45-yard line, Dodge will try it again. It is third down and 10 now for the Texas Longhorns, trailing 55-17. Dodge sets up, throws it. Good catch. And they rule he was out of bounds. He was knocked out by Corbin. And they do not give Hayes the completed pass. Now, maybe the in the official judgment, had he even not been knocked out, he would not have been able to come down with 1 foot inbound.
Exactly. If he makes the catch and is knocked out, but if he's not hit, he comes down inbounds. And we'll see it here now. It's an outrun by Russell Hayes. Just an out pattern. He goes up here to catch the ball. Now, if he comes down of his own volition.
Oh, I don't know about that.
That's a questionable call. I think he'd have come down by himself inbounds had he not been bumped out.
I don't think there's any question about it. It's fourth down and 10 now. But it's certainly too late to make any difference in this football game. And that pass is incomplete by Dodge, intending it for Bill Boy Bryant. And so the ball will go over to Iowa on downs as Texas fails on fourth and 10. And still plenty of time left. 7.5 minutes to play in the game. It's still Iowa 57 and Texas 17. When we come back, the Hawkeyes will have the football. Well, the Freedom Bowl Committee has announced a figure of 24,093. Is that ticket sold? We had understood that they had sold closer to 30,000, so there's a bit of a discrepancy there. And the handoff, Iowa keeping the ball on the ground. Jack, isn't there some rule in the NCAA that you have to sell 40% of capacity in order to keep your bowl going?
I think for the bowl games, yes. I believe they sold about 30,000 seats for the day's game, which means there's probably 25,000 in attendance, which isn't bad for the weather we're having. If we'd had good weather, we'd have been at that 30,000 or better mark, I think. I think to have this bowl back again next year, they had to have sold 26 or 28, and they were over that. There's no question of that. It's going to be a great bowl in the future.
So it's second down and 7 now for Iowa, just working on the clock. And yes, Chuck Long is still in their quarterback after Vlasic suffered the wrist injury, and we have no report as he was hurried off to the dressing room for x-rays. Here's Long now just pitching on every down, and they knocked him down that time. The frustration of Tony DeGrade, was that number 99? It was. He really leveled Long, and Chuck is still down in his pants now, getting up slowly and looking around like what happened.
He wants to know what truck that was that ran over, looking for the license plate number.
Well, you know DeGrade is frustrated. The Lombardi Trophy winner just hasn't been a factor in his football game at all tonight.
Well, there's a little humiliation, too. They've got two outstanding All-Americans, Tony DeGrade and Jerry Gray, and, you know, they're down mentally and emotionally. They're down, and you get frustrated, and things happen that you wish wouldn't, but oftentimes that they do.
6 minutes to play in the game, third down and 5. I wonder if Fred Akers is counting the seconds like we are, Jack. Here's the give to the 40-yard line. And the carry made by C. Was that ball carrier was number 25, Marshall Cotton. Well, now we got to go very deep to find the people who are running the football. Number 25, Marshall Cotton, the ball carrier. And he was stopped by Bill Hethcock, number 68. And it's fourth down for Iowa, and I believe they will punt the ball away. In to do it is number 3. Well, they got Tom Nickel on the field. They're going to let Nickel do some punting. Costa Bala, of course, is their normal punter, but Nickel, who's the place kicker, can also punt the ball, and he punts it very well. Kind of pooches it down there, and it bounces into the end zone. It'll go as a touchback and come back out to the 20-yard line. So Texas gets it back again. 40 yards on the punt by Tom Nickel. There's a timeout in the action again. Under 6 minutes to play in the game. And you know the score. Iowa's up by 38. And we're back in Anaheim again. Texas from the 20-yard line now. Again, trying to gain some respectability and get something more on the board here before the end of the football game. And Dodge gives on the delay to Terry Orr for about 4 yards to the 24-yard line. So Texas still going with their frontline people. I'm wondering why perhaps Akers, with this game out of reach, wouldn't give some of his players who have worked hard all season long and not had a chance to play much an opportunity, although Danny Akers, I see, is in a quarter. No, he's not. Danny Akers particularly, his own son, who hasn't been in this game, although he's got another year of eligibility left. Dodge is going all the way at quarterback, and he remains in there. Rain continues to come down. He throws this one up for grabs, and it's intercepted by number 90, Doug Burrell, a sophomore out of Cedar Rapids, Iowa. 6'2", 203-pound defensive end. That's got to be a great thrill. It was intended for Rob Morshall, but Burrell is the man who stepped in front of the errant pass by Todd Dodge.
Look at it again right there. There it is. Great anticipation by number 90, Doug Burrell. Big thrill for him.
And so Iowa goes on offense again. And let's see, Chucky Long is coming out to quarterback him also. So apparently they are not going to use Harmon at all and just let Long take this win to its natural conclusion. You can see the sadness in the face of the Texas football players, and they certainly have come up a little bit short in this football game tonight. Back at the 27-yard line. Now some pushing and shoving, and the frustration is beginning to show, and they're all standing over Chuck Long. I bet he loves that, Jack.
Yeah, that's the last place I'd want to be, is right down underneath all that beef. They better get out of there.
Yeah, he fumbled a snap, and I think under these circumstances, if I were to fumble a snap, I'd just get out of there. Let everybody else fight for it. And the game obviously has deteriorated somewhat, not only with the weather conditions, but with this game having been decided in the third quarter, and Long having accomplished so much in this football game tonight, breaking school records, setting Freedom Bowl records in the inaugural performance that they may be looking at for some years to come. 31 points in the third quarter. The scoreboard really tells it all. And here they come breaking offside now. And again, the frustration of Tony DeGray, who has been blocked extremely well by that offensive line. Don Kellogg, number 55, has played very well. Glass, Sinlinger, Wester, O'Brien. They've used Humphrey on occasion.
Mark Spranger's in there now, number 53, doing a fine job at offensive center for the Hawkeyes.
At this time, TCS Metro Sports would like to thank the following individuals for their assistance in the production of tonight's telecast. From the University of Iowa, Athletic Director Bump Elliott, Head Coach Hayden Fry, Sports Information Director George Wine, and his assistant Phil Hattie, who was particularly helpful to us this week. And for the University of Texas, Athletic Director DeLos Dodds, Head Football Coach Freddie Akers, Sports Information Director Bill Little, and from the Freedom Bowl, the Executive Director Tom Starr. And here is the give to the running back, trying to get outside of the 30-yard line. Number 25, Cotton, is the ball carrier. And Marshall picks up a couple of yards as the clock continues to run now. 3:18, 3:17 to go in the game. And the Iowa Hawkeyes will have the distinction of being the first ever winner of the Freedom Bowl. Perfect place. I think there's been a lot of discussion this week, Jack, about the fact that why didn't anybody ever bring a bowl out to Orange County, California before this?
Well, it's a great place to have a game. I mean, the weather's fantastic. The facilities are exceptional, with the exception of the rain. I mean,
yep.
This is bad timing by the weatherman. But other than that, everything here is outstanding. The beaches, the mountains, Disneyland's here.
Well, it's for sure that Iowa loves to play on the grass. As Long goes back to pass, looking for more records, throws one downfield, and it's incomplete. He was looking for an out pattern from his receiver, who instead chose the post. And when you're playing with third and fourth team players, I guess it's understandable. Kerry Burt, the wide receiver, ran a post, and Long threw it outside. But as I started to say, Iowa has played on natural grass only once this year. They played Purdue, and they beat him decisively, 40-3. So I imagine Hayden Fry's crew likes the feel of his grass.
I don't think so. It's a tight grass down there. It's cut very, very short. It's a nice facility. They keep excellent care of it here at Anaheim City. They have a great ground crew.
Iowa with 562 total net yards in this football game. Texas with 292. We're at 854 now and counting. We'll lose some there. The tackle made all the way back at the 40-yard line. And apparently it's been fumbled and recovered by Texas. So the Longhorns will have the football from their own 40-yard line. We are now 2.5 minutes of counting, and Long trying to explain to Hayden Fry what happened. What went wrong, said Hayden Fry. As if he really cares. He's a very cooperative gentleman and a very charming man. He very helpful to us this week.
Absolutely. Very, very pleasant to work with. Gave us all the information we asked, and he was an outstanding young man. Represents the state of Iowa very, very well.
34th year in coaching for Hayden Fry. Would you believe that Bum Phillips used to be on his staff? And Dodd dumps it off on the sideline. Terry Orr takes it out of bounds across the 42-yard line. And that will stop the clock after a short yard gain and 2:23 to play in the game.
Joe Schuster's in there. I saw him as a defensive lineman. Sophomore, 6'4", 260-pounder. He's in there getting some playing time for Iowa.
Well, I wish you a great trip to Honolulu, Jack, and to the rest of our crew that's going along. And I hope you have maybe a more competitive football game with Texas and SMU than we did here in the second half of this game, although Iowa just has played so extremely well in long a record performance. Here's another almost interception. In and out of the hands, Ken Sims had it, was probably looking at the goal line when that ball was delivered, and he was the only man around it. And he just simply got a little bit excited and dropped the football. So it goes as an incompleted pass. It'll be third down now for Texas.
Make a point here too, Sam, is that I think some of the people from Texas have to realize one thing, that Texas has come off their last two ball games. They have lost both games, Baylor, but to Baylor, 24-10, and to A&M, 37-12. Whereas Iowa, their last game, they won. So that the emotional aspect or approach is a little bit different.
I believe I said Texas and SMU in the Aloha. It's, of course, Notre Dame and SMU. And that pass completed on third down keeps the drive alive for Texas at the 45-yard line. And they move the clock now at 2:11. And they will stop it and move the chains. Kevin Nelson with reception number 32. And no, this one may be coming back. Apparently a penalty marker was down. Anything to prolong the agony here. There you see Danny Akers, number 12, along the sideline, loosening up his right arm. He, of course, is the son of Texas head coach Freddie Akers. I don't know whether he's going to come in or not. Oh, he threw the ball. It goes to show you how much my head's in the game here in the last couple of minutes. That was Akers who threw the ball, so he completed his first pass, and then they took it away from him. So it's nullified on the penalty, and they go back to the 42-yard line. We're all getting a little bit sloppy here. Here's Akers again. And he's got Orr and Nelson behind him. Danny sets up, fires the ball again to Nelson at the 46-yard line. And the tackle made by Steve Brown. That'll be a long flight back to Texas.
Steve Brown made the stop.
Akers, the quarterback, was probably saying to himself, "Daddy, how much do you really love me now? We're down 55-17, and you're putting me in there? Wait a minute."
Well, it's been a really topsy-turvy season for Texas, and they've been on the emotional skids as of late. And for a team that was number one, 7, 8, 9 weeks ago,
that's right,
to have fallen this far, it's got to obviously sadden the folks around that great university. But they have such an outstanding program that it won't take much to mend it, I'm sure.
Well, what people have got to realize, Sam, and you must realize this, is that you're not going to see, with an exception, teams going undefeated. There's just too much parity in college football today. You know, when you come out with a 7-3-1 or 7-4 or 8-3, 9-2, those are great records. You got to be very, very proud of that. You're not going to see the 12 BYU this year, 12-0. We understand that. But as a rule, year in and year out, the top 10, you're not going to find any undefeated team.
That's a good point. That's an excellent point, Jack. And I think that's one reason that Hayden Fry was particularly incensed at the Iowa writers, or a few of them, who ridiculed him for accepting a bowl invitation to play here in Anaheim. With a 7-4, he had a 6-4-1 record when he accepted the invitation. And, you know, he came out here and said, "Hey, we have nothing to be ashamed of. We are a very good football team. We lost to Michigan State. We felt that an official's call may have cost us a 2-point conversion that would have won it. And then we sat and watched Ohio State obliterate Michigan and take away any chances we had to go into the Rose Bowl. And then we had to go out and play Minnesota, and obviously we're down, and Minnesota beat us." And so he defended the fact that they came out here 7-4-1, having accepted the invitation at 6-4-1. And I think you make an excellent point. With the competitiveness of college football today, there's no shame. And so there are a lot of schools that love to be 7-4-1 when it's all over. And Long now just running out the clock, giving off to the running back, Kevin Harmon. And we are at 30 seconds and counting. And this game is about to go in the record books. And of course, there's no way of telling who will be here next year for the Freedom Bowl. It's been a great week with you, Jack, and I appreciate the time. Of course, you live out here in Southern California. Thank you for chauffeuring me around. I appreciate that.
Don't ever let it happen again,
Sam. No, sir. No, sir, I will. I'll bring my own chauffeur next time. And good luck at the Aloha Bowl. I'm sure you'll have a good time over there. This one is history. And while I'm at it, just a personal note, you know, when you're away for the holidays, it's always nice to have family and friends, and I'm indebted to Ronnie and Carolyn Baker and Ronnie Ridge for making it like home for me out here during Christmas, and to our great crew and our support crew here, as I mentioned, Chuck Panama, Jim Pels, Charles Fisher, and John Grohol, Tammy Rippey, and the rest of our production crew, who are all away from home for the holidays, and hoping that you enjoyed the telecast, even if you were a Texas fan. The football game is history. The final score, the inaugural Freedom Bowl, Iowa 55, the Texas Longhorns 17. We'll be right back after this. So from high above the Big A, Sam Nover welcoming you back to Anaheim with the final score again was 55-17 Iowa. If you joined us late, the Hawkeyes got off and running, take advantage of a couple of Texas turnovers. Chucky Long with a couple of first quarter touchdown passes, 14-0 at the turn. They went to the half, 24-17. Texas came back, and we thought we had a competitive football game, but it was all Iowa in the third quarter, outscoring the Longhorns 31-0. They win the ball game going away 55-17. We'll be back with some postgame comments right after this. Back at the Big A in Anaheim, you see a very happy Hayden Fry, the head coach of the Iowa Hawkeyes, and his team crowded around at a post-game ceremony as they are being awarded the first ever Freedom Bowl trophy, and they certainly deserved it, did they not, Jack Snow?
Absolutely. There's Chuck Long. You're looking, as we mentioned earlier, probably the Dan Marino of college football this evening.
William Harris.
I don't think it comes as any great surprise that Chuck Long has just been named the MVP of this football game, and well, he might. He threw for over 450 yards. He is the most valuable player, at least for Iowa, and the tight end Harris received the MVP award for the Texas Longhorns, and a deserved honor, although you and I voted for June James, quite honestly, and we thought he played an outstanding defensive game as well.
Two excellent choices, though. Both offensive players, which I love to see, but I'll tell you what, two outstanding performances, some good catches by Long's receivers. I mean, I'm wore out. I mean, I'm watching that guy. It's like the 4th of July here tonight.
And maybe we ought to apologize, or at least I should, for getting a little bit sloppy late in the football game, but it got to be to a point where when you're leading 55-17 at the end of three quarters, everybody just wanted the whole thing perhaps to end, although nobody's going to quit. And you know that Freddie Akers in Texas did not quit. Here's Hayden Fry. Let's see if we can't eavesdrop on some of his comments right now.
Associated with the Freedom Bowl. God bless you. You had enough faith in the Hawkeyes to give us an invitation when we were flat of our back. We got up off our back and beat a mighty fine team from the University of Texas. The Hawkeyes are the winners of the first Freedom Bowl, and we love it. Thank you.
And so Hayden Fry has put the finishing touches on an invitation, a trip, and a victory that he thought all along his football team deserved, and they went out and proved it tonight. 55-17, the Hawkeyes over Texas. We'll be back with more of our postgame report in just a moment. So I think it's safe to assume that nobody expected that kind of final score to be posted and 72 points to be scored in this football game. Jack, that being the biggest surprise of all, anything else that might have left you wondering?
Yeah, I was very surprised that Texas couldn't come out and put some more points off on the board in the second half. What happened was they did a good job the first half, 17 points. They came back the second half. I thought they were on a roll. Unfortunately, they couldn't get anything going. They couldn't push the ball in the end zone.
So the final score, as you see it, 55-17, and that does it here from Anaheim, along with my colleague Jack Snow. This is Sam Nover saying so long from Anaheim, California, where the final score of the inaugural Freedom Bowl was Texas 55 and Iowa 17. The executive producer of TCS Metro Sports is Thomas V. Hewitt. Coordinating producer, Paul Carlson. This game has been produced by Paul Carlson and directed by Thomas Hewitt. Technical director, Mike Giannottis. Technical supervisor, Gary Cundy. The technical director, Gary Clem. Pre-game producer, Mike Kobik. And the associate producer, Tammy Rippey. Production and technical facilities supplied by TCS Productions, Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. The blimp provided by the Goodyear Tire and Rubber Company. This has been an exclusive TCS Metro Sports presentation.